Hello and welcome back to another exciting Humanastory Life in Review by your host, Brian Klein, on this wonderful Humanastory evening. Earlier on the 9th of January, we spoke with Mr. Mark Emke about his Life in Review, and I must say it was amazing, and yes, a part of humanity's thought process from around the world. We stood in awe of how brilliant humanity is and how people really act. And while we are consistently bombarded by mass media of how awful the world can be, we at Humanastory seek out those who are willing to brave the craziness that we call life to share their story with us. You can check out his interview at humanastory.com. Today I will be joined by Christina Klein, the woman who makes my adventures come true, and by Mark Emke, whom over the years, like mold on a wall, grows on you with time. Today in our sights, we have Mr. Mark Sargent, the man behind enclosedworld.com. Short of finding out what side of the bed he sleeps on and what color his underwear is, we will find out what it takes to make him tick. We will find out if he's real or faking it. And we will find out if he's really the amazing Mr. Sargent, the Emperor of the United States, he claims to be.
We all know Mr. Mark Sargent's crazy, thought-provoking theory and his yearning to find the truth. Through the years, he's made many enemies and even more allies. But do we really know who he is?
Can this man really be trusted? You can find the live thread at our community under Humanastory Presents Mark Sargent for your questions to be answered. All right, it is 8:01 p.m. and this is Humanastory Presents A Life in Review with Mark Sargent. So before we begin, we are all going to proceed as the parties are innocent and clean slated from this point moving onward, as a fresh beginning needs to start in this way. Mark Sargent, you are now in the Humanastory chair. Mark, you once stated in a previous interview with another host, I have but only one membership, the Flat Earth Society. And we will further this by stating after today, Humanastory will offer you an intimacy even which the society cannot. You will have told us your life story, and perhaps to only one other person, your mother. We offer our hand as Humanastorians to you. Would you accept this title too? As the second club you belong to, Humanastory is the story of humanity one person at a time. You can don't have to answer now. We'll ask it again in the end. In this interview today, we will not hide behind the masks of anonymity. And there are no trolls here, and none will be tolerated. Everyone here will have an open mind and listen to what you have to say as another living, breathing human being on this planet. With all the conspiracies aside, and all preconceived thoughts on wording symbolism aside, as an ism is defined by a distinct practice, a system or philosophy, typically a political ideology or an artistic movement. So let's begin. As I stated before, we will need to start fresh. I would like to start this off by explaining the intention of this interview. Mark, I won't be hitting conspiracy or flat earth too hard, though we will touch on some aspects of the conspiracy realm to better understand you, but rather we will be talking about you and your past. As open as you are, and you talk a lot, there's no real information as to the type of person you are, or what kind of characteristic moral values you have, let alone whom you derive your philosophies from. This, to us, is important because to understand what kind of person you were in the past will show what type of person you are now, and to show the world if you can be trusted as a person moving forward. This segment will not be about flat earth or conspiracies at all. This particular segment is about Mr. Sargent, the man, and his thoughts on his childhood to adulthood. to better understand the man, Mark Sargent. If Humanastory, or any other person who calls during this broadcast, asks a question too direct or too uncomfortable, you have the option to opt out by saying, "I don't feel I would like to answer that." You will not be judged here. Mark, again, we will be talking straight, with all conspiracies aside. Will you be okay to continue with this?
Yes. Yes, I would.
Before we begin, we would like your listeners right now to put any false notions in their heads away for this interview. Both of your thoughts and ours, for both your thoughts and ours, those who can't can either clearly be trolling, and we don't want any of that. So, our thoughts on conspiracy. Mr. Sargent, we know that you dabbled a little bit into conspiracy, and I hesitate to use the word because those of us who do any real serious research know that there are trigger words out there that are put out there to shut down the complex human brain by both the accusers and the accused. Both parties are fully aware of this happening, yet during any real debate or any real interview, whether by influence or the simplistic passage of time, the debate or the interviews usually go right into the gutter as a result of one or both sides pushing this issue. Furthermore, they both end up using symbolic viewpoints, such as that of accusing each other of Nazism in the end. This ultimately destroying both their viewpoints and ultimately getting nowhere as the end result. It can't all be conspiratorial agenda by every living person. Realistically, why do you think people make almost every popular major event a serious conspiracy rather than seeing it for face value?
Mostly because the people... When it comes to the major events of this world, and I'd be the first one to say that, just about every major event in this world is not what it appears to be. Or the old saying, and that is, at face value, things are never what they appear at first glance. How many instances do you want, or sayings do you want, where history is written by the winners, or that great Napoleon saying, and that is, history is just lies that were agreed upon. Once you kind of know that, you kind of look at all, everything that's happened from just going way back, but especially in America. America seems to be founded on misconceptions and half-truths and, spinning it a certain way so that the population, everyone likes to be the good guys. The winners like to be portrayed. Nobody likes to be the bad guys or the villains in the movie. And so that's really where it starts. And then you get a small sector of the population, which are naturally suspicious to just about everything. And I'm one of them, no question. But to be fair, my first conspiracy, I was completely naive and completely blind to everything, blissfully ignorant all the way up until, for a lot of people, including me, the word conspiracy didn't exist until I saw JFK, the movie, in the theaters in the early 90s. And that's when all of a sudden it dawned on me. It's like, really? People lie? Not just people, but authority figures lie. I mean, we've all heard about, car salesmen and politicians and stuff like that. But you never, conspiracy, the clinical definition is that, it's a group of people that that plot to, to commit an act. And, after that, you just start looking at more and more things. I mean, it only takes one. That's the thing of conspiracies. After the first one, it's easy to start being suspicious of other things. And sometimes it gets taken too far where we're suspicious of everything. But at the same time, there's a lot of stuff to be suspicious about. So how's that?
Okay, so I'm going to further this statement to the audience and challenge them all, both yours and mine, both in live chat and in the comment section of YouTube. Can you actually hold a mature adult thought process when debating your points, or further prove mine by how immature you can be, by how stupid you guys really act, the problem that we have is, I know you shut off all your comments, or you don't even look at them because there's just so many trolls. Well, yeah. Let's see if they, well, how they'll react to everything. But I digress. The second anyone uses these words, okay, back to what we were saying, the second anyone uses these words, they're immediately referred to as a lunatic, or when the conspirator, even if the conspirator is correct. So let's say that 9/11 is a prime example. You know, you say it could have been an inside job. The thing with 9/11 is, did George Bush know about it? Really, that's what everybody really wants to know.
Yeah.
It's hard to say no. When in World War II, Pearl Harbor was a prime example. The president knew it was going to get hit. But why did we get involved? We got involved because of a... We needed to, otherwise there would have been serious consequences. Not saying it was the right or good thing to do. That's just, we had to. And America didn't want to. So, is it possible that 9/11 was an inside job? Possibly. Did he know about it? Most definitely. We would like to a deeper understanding as to where all this began for you. Not just the moment, not just with the movement that you've taken on, but how someone so seemingly intelligent and stimulating and well thought out could get wrapped up in even the simplest of conspiracies. We're going to start asking about your childhood. The reason that I want to bring all this in is, okay, at what point does the Salem witch trial behavior, and, you know, when does it stop? You know, because we were talking the other day about Salem witch trials, which got me thinking, you know, when does this behavior stop? And, you know, when do people concede to be things that could be true might actually indeed be true? And at what point do we put logic that we have in our heads to work, you know, to what is actually being said without anonymity? Now, there's more to this. And, you know, I'm running out of time. We did 15-minute segments, but, you know, when we come back, we're going to touch on this. But it's, when can people be true without using anonymity? All the while standing up because we believe through our own courses of research, this logic, whatever it is, to be true. My point in case is going to start with Tim Osman, which is a prime example, whom has been quoted by his own volition, by his own words, to you, secretly recording you. I do troll, and I troll hard using different names. From what I understand through my own research of this Tim Osman, it's not even his real name, which means he's hiding behind the very thing I'm talking about, which is the mask of anonymity. And I notice that many people behind darkness, they hide behind darkness to be rude and conspiratorial. I mean, I've been on your forums. I've looked in your... not you particularly. I mean, you and Patricia are pretty much the only two that I've run into that are genuine. And why I say that is because you two don't hide behind a mask, which I'm going to touch on here. Okay? But... You know, they can't man up to be who they really are with what they really believe. And almost everyone we run into expects the truth, right? But they can't be truthful to themselves. And to me, that's very hypocritical. Which really puts a sore damper into what you're trying to do. And it also shows how cowardly people are. Our question to you tonight is, is Mark Sargent your real name or a pseudonym? And would you be honest with yourself when answering that question alone? And this, this is the answer you're going to give. Is this the same answer you would give yourself? In other words, would you lie to yourself to get what you want?
So am I supposed to answer that?
So yes, now you can.
Okay. Okay.
It's a long question, and I know that some of these are going to be long-winded, but
no,
they
okay.
need to be explained.
Sure.
Because a
sure.
lot of people have these questions, and then you'll see people get all pissed off, You know, why is that host long-winded? I'm sorry, but you know what? If you want a full answer, a real in-depth answer, you have to have an in-depth question.
Sure, mm-hmm. treat it like court. Sorry. I completely understand. And yes, my real born God-given name is Mark Kendall, K-E-N-D-A-L-L, Sargent, S-A-R-G-E-N-T, born in Seattle, Washington, 1968.
Okay, so we've only got 10 seconds in this segment, and we'll be back here shortly, guys, in just a few seconds. So hang in there and keep... Humanastory is the story of humanity, one person at a time. We believe each person has a story to tell, and each story shapes that person into who they are today. Collectively, and more importantly, each and every person's story shapes this little blue rock we call home. We are all together whether we like it or not. We also believe that your unique story might just help someone else traveling down your pathway in life. You might be their guide through this rough time. We are always looking for more exciting stories to share with the world. If you've got one, come share it with us today. All right, so we're back with segment two. And we were asking Mark at the very beginning, at the end of the last segment, Mark,
yeah.
Is your real name Mark Sargent?
Yes.
I know it's really
it is.
Question,
it absolutely
it?
is really Mark Sargent. No,
okay,
no question.
Okay, so as we all know, our past is what makes us who we are today. And as a famous philosopher once said, by all outward appearances, our life is a spark of light between one eternal darkness and another. Nor is that interval between two nights an unclouded day. With that said, Mr. Sargent, we would like to know about you and your childhood as it shapes the fabric of who you morally are today. Mark, tell us where you were born, live, etc. as a child.
Sure. I was born in Seattle, Washington, 1968, and shortly thereafter, because you know, there's not a lot of hospitals, or at least there weren't on the island in the 60s. I moved to a place called Whidbey, W-H-I-D-B-E-Y, Island, which is north of Seattle, but just south of the San Juans. So the north part of Whidbey Island is the south part of the San Juans, if anybody's heard of that, which is right next to Canada, right next to Vancouver, Canada. And I grew up on the south end. You know, it's a long island. You know, it's pushing 50 miles long as the road goes, but it's very, very narrow. And literally an island. You know, you had to take a ferry to go anywhere, especially if you lived on the south end. And I lived for the first, you know, grade school part of my life, I lived in a place called Hilltop Terrace, which was on the south end. Dad was a mediator between labor and management for quite a while before he became a hatchet man. Mom was a career teacher. And that's where I grew. I went through the entire South Whidbey public school system from elementary to middle school to high school. Never moved. You know, off of the island. When I was, I think, fifth grade, going into sixth grade, we moved to Sunlight Beach, which is on a very interesting cove called Useless Bay. Those haven't heard that, right? That literally was called Useless Bay because the tide goes out so far, especially in the summer, that it's absolutely useless for ships. So they just named it Useless Bay. And of course, you know, growing up there, you know, so I lived there, you know, from sixth grade all the way until I went to college. But I lived a very sheltered life on South Whidbey Island. You know, thought that, you know, took everything at face value. You know, everything you saw in the news was real, and everything in the newspaper. And you know, your parents would never lie to you, and your teachers never lie to you. And nobody would ever lie to you. And so I grew up a very, very blissfully ignorant person. I mean, you want to call it naive, fine. And if there was an award during high school for most gullible in my class, I absolutely would have gotten it. So, there you have
it. Okay, what about your earliest childhood memory?
Earliest childhood memory. Probably, I know what it is. Earliest childhood memory would have been on Hilltop Terrace. Must have been 4 or 5, I think. And maybe 4. It was definitely during the summer, though. And my earliest memory was literally wait. It was like I woke up flat on my back in the middle of this field.
Flat?
Yeah, flat. Exactly. Yeah, flat on my back in the middle of this field, looking up at the sky and the sun. You know, it's the Northwest does get some great sunny days in the summer, and the sun was just beaming down. And I remember it was so surreal, you know, and looking over, and my sister, who was only 11 months younger than me, was laying, you know, not that far away from me, also on her back, just staring up at the sky. And it was just one of those beautiful, wonderful, you know, kid moments. And we woke up, and you know, whatever it was, and just, you know, ran towards the house. And it was a cool thing. But yeah, that was probably my earliest memory.
Good. How has it influenced you today?
That earliest memory?
Mm-hmm.
Always, you know, again, you know, since there weren't a lot of real dark moments in my life, it probably kept me optimistic about a lot of things. It really helped when I was, you know, when you grow up on, you know, very sheltered on an island, it's you don't see the bad things. You know, you only remember, yeah, you know, that was a great start. So it just kind of helped shape my optimism, in anything, in athletics and schoolwork and projects, you know, that anything was possible. And that really carried with me. Again, it really literally wasn't until my early 20s that I realized that there was a real dark side to this world. So yeah, before then it was all peaches and gravy.
What'd you want to do as a child? What'd you want to do if you grew up?
That always changed. It was one of those things where it's like, oh, I want to be a fireman or an astronaut. Funny, the astronaut part. Or a sports hero, baseball star. There wasn't any of those things. The male role models in my family all did things that seemed to be, I suppose, worthwhile to them, but they weren't very interesting. In my opinion, you know, my uncle owned a construction company. My grandfather was a CPA. The other grandfather was an engineer. You know, my dad did various things, ended up being a hatchet man. I didn't even know what that was, although he was a recruiter in the 70s. So I didn't really want, I think what I was trying to figure out when I was going my childhood, what did I want to be? Because the opportunities were all over the place. So that's what I was kind of feeling my way out through, at least my first 3 years of college.
Was there anything that you feel negatively impacted or influenced your life from childhood that still haunts you today?
Negatively, probably the only thing was the testing that I had done when I was in kindergarten, because I'm not going to say that I felt cheated, but what happened was, because, you know, I'm pretty smart when it comes to a lot of stuff, and my problem solving abilities are I consider very, very creative. And so I was tested during my first couple days of kindergarten. You know, they took me into a room and gave me a bunch of tests for some reason. I didn't know why. I mean, I was only 5. And they immediately said, okay. And then they pulled me out of the classroom and they took me down the hall, and that was it. I was now in first grade. And it was odd. And what that did. It is odd. You look at it and you're just like, okay, so what did I do? I mean, my reading comprehension was really the big one, because that's all you really know when you're that young. It's not like I was doing calculus or anything. But what that did was it shifted my timeline completely forward. So I was always – and I was young for my class to begin with. So, I mean, I graduated high school when I was 16. And, you know, when I went to college, I was emotionally even more naive and probably not ready for anything, because I was just so young. And so, yeah, if it was any dark moment, that was probably the darkest, just because it carried with me the entire time. I was always the youngest. I was always, you know, falling behind. And because women mature faster than men do, you know, at those younger ages, I wasn't keeping up with the whole dating thing. It wasn't. I mean, I grew very fast, and I was smart, but emotionally, I wasn't. You know, keeping pace. And so, yeah, that carried with me. And so one of those things I said, yeah, if I ever finish my time machine or get to change my timeline, that'd probably be the first thing I'd look at is, okay, because it changed. But the chain of events that led to even where I am now, talking to you right now, all hinged on that. Everything went back to, okay, my choice of colleges changed, and then what I did with my fireworks changed, and then when I started playing video games, then I went to Colorado and doing, you know, all the way into the flat earth. So yeah, that was probably the one thing.
Okay, and how has the influence changed your thoughts as an adult now?
It made me look at possibilities. It
did. Making you think.
Yeah. It had me looking at timelines more than anything. It had me look at chains of events. So, which really, really helped me in some ways, because I looked forward and I said, you know, when I looked at anything, it's like, okay, how does this, what I'm doing now, affect this, and then branches off from that, and that tomorrow, and after that, how will it affect the long term? And so when I was like, you know, looking at events in history, I could kind of follow the chain backwards and look at the decision-making process of all that was going on. So it very much helped me in that aspect. It just changed how I looked at things long term.
All right. And did you ever do anything as a child that negatively impacted or influenced another person's life from childhood that still haunts you today?
There was one thing. And only one thing. And I'd actually thought about that before. You know, I'm introspective enough that I was like, okay, have I ever actually done anything, you know, bad to somebody where, you know, you really felt like, you know, if I was ever in a 12-step program, you'd have to go back and, you know, apologize to them.
What are you doing? Are you sitting home going, what's Brian going to ask?
No, not at all. No, I mean, I've thought about a lot. I mean, again, because I've thought about the chain of events that you know, it's like, how did I get this? You know, how did I get this far? I've analyzed a lot of different aspects of my life.
Well, being introspective, you know, being that kind of person where you can do that, that's actually considered an elevated way of thinking.
Oh, that's good. Well, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool. The one thing I did was it was actually during my freshman year, I think, of high school, which I would have been, you know, super young. I would have been 13, something like that. There was a kid who was getting picked on behind someone else's back. You know, there was like a group of guys, right? And, you know, they considered themselves pretty cool. And there was this kind of, you know, fringe kid that he'd be like, hey, guys, what's going on? And as soon as he, like, left their sight, they would just be bad-mouthing him and just saying all these horrible things. And I called these guys on it, and I said, look, why don't you just tell him you don't want to hang out with him instead of doing all this stuff? You know, why are you being this way? And they just go, no, they were mouth breathing troglodytes, and they were just useless. So I had it in my head, it's like, you know what, I can solve this, I can fix this right now. And so when it came to the end of the year, when we were signing annuals, you know, and this kid asked me to sign his annual, you know, this fringe kid, and I took it, and I basically wrote like half a page, and I shouldn't have done it. At the very least, I shouldn't have done it on the inside cover. But I basically laid it out, and I said, look, you got to know where you are right now. And you know, you got to be careful about who you have for friends, because the guys that you're hanging out with are not the guys you should be hanging out with. And here's why. And the thing was, I went to these guys and I put it to them. I go, you know what? I went to this group and I said, look, sign this and end this right now so that you don't have to deal with this. You know, I considered it, granted, it was faulty logic. I was only 13, but it was conflict resolution at my point. And they wouldn't sign it. They wouldn't even come near it. And I said, you guys are all cowards. And so I took it to them and I gave it to them. And he was really, really hurt, extremely hurt. And he had a twin brother, and he went to me and he goes, why would you do this? You know? And, you know, I tried to explain myself, and, in hindsight, yeah, I mean, it bothered me a lot. You know, I could have done it better. Of course, I was so young that, you know, I just blamed it on, you know, I just didn't have much experience in that sort of thing, but it bothered me And, you know, I don't know if I ever truly apologized to him later. I know I apologized to his, in fact, his brother was a roommate of mine in college when we went later at college. So I ran into this guy later on when he was in his 20s and everything was fine. You know, he had moved on with his life and time heals all wounds, that sort of stuff. But yeah, it bugged me.
So have you ever made up for it? I know you said you apologized. So
I did, in my opinion, but I don't, you know, it's still something that, you know, again, if I had to go back in the time machine and do it over again, I absolutely would do it a different way.
But don't worry, we're going to ask you about that time machine shortly.
Okay. Yeah, we'll get to that.
All right.
We'll get to that, though.
that's what I would do. I would go back and
you're answering my next question. Would you be willing to attempt to make up for it now as a mature adult?
Oh, sure. Sure, absolutely. But he knows where I stand now. I mean, again, we dealt with this 20-something years
ago. All right, not to cut you off. Sure. We're going to go for the second break, and we'll be right back, guys. Humanastory is the story of humanity, one person at a time. We believe each person has a story to tell, and each story shapes that person into who they are today. Collectively, and more importantly, each and every person's story shapes this little blue rock we call home. We are all together whether we like it or not. We also believe that your unique story might just help someone else traveling down your pathway in life. You might be their guide through this rough time. We are always looking for more exciting stories to share with the world. If you've got one, come share it with us today. You did what? You shot how many people? Oh, wait, we're on the air again. Okay. All right,
I just shot Mr. Bubbles.
Okay, so could you be honest with yourself when talking about your childhood to yourself in a mirror? If you were looking at your childhood self right now, what would you tell yourself?
Oh, if I was telling my younger self right now.
If you were looking in a mirror at your childhood self and your childhood self, kind of like the Harry Potter where he looks in the mirror and he sees, what would you say?
Well, not knowing when the cutoff would be, let's say that I, because I couldn't lead him into what was going to happen all the way up through, you know, into my 40s. But as far as my childhood goes, I'd tell him, you know what, treat every day, you know, like it's an opportunity more than anything, because I wouldn't really want to change that much. I'd like to see more opportunities taken, maybe. But I was extremely fortunate when it came to, you know, just the circumstances that were around my life. You know, even though I was kind of shifted forward and was put kind of at a little bit of a disadvantage. Really, again, growing up on an island with a very supportive family and, you know, a sister that even though we kind of fought tooth and nail, you know, I completely understood her and she, you know, we kept our distance later. The rest of it was pretty great. You know, I had some wonderful friends and I met a lot of great people, and it was a, you know, yes, I was naive, but I don't think I would have changed that because, you know, some people when they're growing up, if they're exposed to too many, real negative things when they're growing up, as you know, can do a lot of damage and really, you know, turn someone down a dark path. And my path was always, you know, light and joy and creativity and focus. And again, anything was possible, that there was really no limits. And, you know, it was that, again, naive, but at the same time, you know, walking through minefields, you know, without even knowing you're in a minefield, that was pretty much what I was doing on a regular basis. My line was, what could possibly go wrong? You know, that quintessential line you hear in television and movies. That was me. So, yeah, I would tell myself, you know, treat every day like it's an opportunity and, you know, don't waste anything. You know, just, you know, take the chances.
All right. Do you have any regrets from your childhood?
Not
I changed voice.
Yeah, you like that?
Not really. Regrets. There may be a few regrets as far as, again, chances I didn't take. But it was mostly because I was emotionally, a little bit behind the girls I was dating. So, you know, they were expecting a certain level of sophistication, maturity, whatever you want to call it. And mm-hmm. I just wasn't there yet. So regrets, not so much regrets as, I don't think there was anything that I wrung my hands over later. It was, I felt for me, my life seemed to have been a series of people, kind of like a square dance, an old cowboy square dance, where, do si do, and, when someone would be with you for a couple revolutions and then they would let go. And then all of a sudden you'd spin around and there'd be another person. I felt it many times during my life that I was not really guiding my life, that there was something else that was guiding my life, that I was really just a passenger on a ride. And it was trying to accept that, which was, it was difficult because I wanted to fight against it. It's like, no, I'm in control of my own destiny. And so many times I was proven wrong, to where now I literally just go with wherever it's taking me, which is why, I'm doing the flat earth thing. Anyway, sorry.
Right.
It was long-winded.
That's okay. So what five positive things could you say you gained from your childhood that still resonate to this day?
Five positive things. Optimism, in the face of adversity. Adaptability, being able to adjust to just about any situation. Hopefully you guys are writing this down because I don't know if I'm going to remember after I'm done with them.
Oh, don't worry. It's all recorded, right? No.
Oh, right. Yeah, you're right. We have the technology. Creativity, where I had a whole bunch of creativity with me, which just carried with my entire life. Problem solving, and those two went hand in hand. So I would come up with ways. Yeah, they may be eccentric and weird of solving something. But it got the thing done, but people look at me, it's like, what made you think of that way to do it? And then, the fifth one, probably just, being eccentric and not caring. I don't know if there's a term for that, but being allowed, what was the old saying? Let your freak flag fly. That one.
Oh, yeah.
I'm gonna say that again. But that's pretty much it. And that is, be eccentric as you want to be and do not care. It's like if they can't understand the frequency that you're on, that's fine, because the people that eventually people will. And I really felt that a lot, that last one there, many times in my life. I really felt like, and I didn't even understand it until I saw Forrest Gump, the movie, when he was jogging back and forth across the country.
I gave you a crowd surge. You can't hear it because I don't know how to make it shine through yours, but crowd just screamed for you because I have.
Oh, okay. Where Forrest Gump was running back and forth across the country, and eventually people started looking at him and saying, that guy knows something. He's on to something. And then all of a sudden he had this following that people would follow him, and he had. He was just running, I love that line. He goes, why are you doing it? You do it for world peace. You do it for hunger. You protesting. He's going, I just felt like running.
Yeah.
And that's really what I was doing most of the time in my life. I was just doing what I wanted to do.
You know what? I think we're both doing it. I'm going to be perfectly honest with you. I think you and I are a lot alike in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
I didn't, my conventional high school years was all spent in a hospital room.
Yeah.
Being ultra MK brainwashed.
Nice.
No, I'm just.
Nice.
No, but I did, though. I spent, I was telling you about it since yeah. I was 13 up until 27. I was doing chemotherapy 6 hours a day, 5 days a week. I wasn't able to go outside. Oof. So I was, I'm 100% with you.
You might as well have been the boy in the bubble, John Travolta.
I literally was.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, so I'm gonna ask you this next question, sure. And then I'll let her continue asking the questions. But this particular question that I wanted to ask, again, pay attention to the wording.
Okay.
What is your most influential experience from your childhood? Would you share it with the world today? I'm not saying positive or negative, but which one had the greatest impact on you?
Most influential. Probably. Oh yeah, it would have been my first kiss, I think, because it was later in my high school career because I was younger, and it was awesome. It was 3 hours.
It was.
I mean, being a naive kid, you know, growing up on an island, and you know, found a pretty girl, and it was just kissing. It was just basically one big long kiss. It lasted 3 hours, and
wow,
it was.
Boy, that's a long kiss.
It was.
Don Suave or what?
No, it was just no. She was good at it, and she taught me how to be good at it, and it was a great, great, wonderful thing. And again, there was nothing real seedy to it. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't weird, and it was such a positive. You know, so many first kisses are awkward and you know, clumsy. And people don't know what to do, and you know, everyone's got horror stories, but mine was just, oh, it was great. And it was just it was such a great kickstart to my, you know, to the energy that was in me.
So is it safe to say that this was not a negative experience?
It was definitely not. I was lit up at that point. I was lit up like a sparkler. And I bet. At that point, I didn't come down for years, and the people that I sought out were people that, you know, I at that point I looked for energy and personality in people more than anything. It was something that I really felt, and so yeah, it was a positively, and it really pushed me to, you know, you hear the saying, and that is you know, avoid negative people.
And so that's why you seek us out. Hold on, I'm gonna give myself an applause. That's right.
Oh yeah, I do. I mean, I love all positive things, and I avoid negative people like the plague. And that it stemmed from that, you know, again, being, you know, growing up sheltered and seeing nothing but positive things, and that was just a such a great thing that it just encouraged me. It's like that there was the reinforcement at that point. It's like at that point I said, "You know what? I'm going to be even more positive than I am already." And I'm, you know, dedicate, you know, everything I've got to, you know, setting a good example and being, you know, being fun and being, you know, the type of person that you could hang around and you couldn't say anything bad about, because I was, you know, I was trying to be a better version of myself at all times. So.
All right. What was your family like as a child? Your mom, dad, brothers, sisters?
I had one sister, younger, 11 months. As a matter of fact, she is the same age as me 13 days out of the year, which is weird because she was 2 grades behind me. And my family was really great. You know, they were very, very supportive. No, they weren't perfect by any stretch. You know, I'll be the first one to say, you know, because I haven't talked to my dad in years. You know, my dad, he had the one flaw. You know, lots of parents have flaws. We all talk about, you know, it's like, oh, he drinks, he smokes, he does all, people do bad things. My dad's weakness was that he liked his secretaries. And, you know, he was not, he hid it as best he could, but it was not great. And so, you know, a divorce was imminent. But I will say this, you know, everything, you know, there was a lot of structure in my family. And so they literally waited until I was driven off to college that, you know, that day when it was that it was dropped on me. I mean, I knew it was coming, but it was like, okay, this is when the breakup's going to occur, is when you head off to college, because, you know, they wanted it to be a you know, kind of a softer landing for me. So... Mm-hmm. That's what happened. I mean, you know, he went his way, and we had words, but you know, he made his decision, and it's like, all right, you know, but up until that point, he was a very, you know, very loving and caring and supportive father. You know, went to all the sporting things and encouraged me to do this and that. And he was very creative and eccentric himself. So, yeah, there you have it.
What about your mom?
Mom was great. She still is great. You know, she was a career teacher and a librarian and a home ec teacher and, you know, deaconess of her church and all these wonderful, wonderful things. Very, very positive. Huge mounds of positive energy. You know, always looked for the silver lining in things, always looked for ways to encourage you and to lessen, you know, maximize the positives and minimize the negatives. And it was great. Again, it was a little weird because, you know, she was a teacher in the school district, so I would have her as a substitute teacher every once in a while. You're not even, I think, legally allowed to do that anymore.
I'm familiar with that myself.
Yeah, but I grew up in a teacher's lounge, so, you know, the buses would go. I never took the bus. You know, it was only on rare occasions I took the bus. So, you know, I grew up in, you know, and so school was different for me. It didn't have the negative connotations that it had for other people. I spent so much time in an empty school, you know, during the summers and after school, before school, you know, it was really interesting. Plus, I knew every teacher. I was on a first name basis, basically, with all of them. And all my teachers were chosen for me on top of that. So, yeah, that was really weird. I didn't even know what registration was. until I got to college, and I was like, where are these lines for? I had no idea.
So what was your most memorable experience with your family that you feel shaped who you are today?
Like just a family thing.
Yeah, we're hitting you hard, buddy.
That's okay. That's okay. No. I mean, I was going to choose either between some sort of weird family trip or probably the, probably one of the 4th of July shows down on Sunlight Beach, during, you know, the first years of high school. I couldn't really pick one in particular, but that was really when I was starting to get out on my own, which was they really expressed, you know, they let me express myself, you know, because I was very creative when it came to fireworks. You know, we lived in the middle of a whole bunch of summer cabins down there. In fact, they're almost all summer cabins now. And there were, you know, a lot of rich people would pay me to put on fireworks shows, you know, because, you know, oh, he's a dumb kid. He has all his fingers, you know, let him blow himself up. And my parents really encouraged that. It was weird. You'd think a lot of parents wouldn't go into
this. Is going to bring me into the passions as a child. Who was your first love? You said you had this long, drawn-out, 3-hour kiss that was so passionate you remember it today. Who was it? Humanastory is the story of humanity, one person at a time. We believe each person has a story to tell, and each story shapes that person into who they are today. Collectively, and more importantly, each and every person's story shapes this little blue rock we call home. We are all together whether we like it or not. We also believe that your unique story might just help someone else traveling down your pathway in life. You might be their guide through this rough time. We are always looking for more exciting stories to share with the world. If you've got one, come share it with us today. Okay, so we were talking with Mr. Mark Sargent about his childhood, and we last asked him what passions did he have as a child and who was his first love. He was on this, like, memory lane kick where he was, I don't know, getting excited on the microphone. So we need to know who.
Really?
Yeah, let's talk about this love.
Right. Okay. So my first love. That's what you want to know.
Yep. That's what we're going for.
My first love was a girl that I met during my second year of college. My first year of college was actually at Washington State University, and I drank my way through that and completely. That year was a write off. So my second year of college, which actually was my first year, my freshman year. Was over at Western Washington University in Bellingham, Washington. And I met a girl there who, her name was a very unusual name. It was Ashanti, A-S-H-A-N-T-I, and her last name was Lee. So her parents, who were huge flower children, which was odd because she was actually a trust fund girl, but she didn't know it, you know, because a lot of trust fund people, you don't tell them until it actually happens. That way they don't lose motivation. The first name was based off an African tribe and her last name was based off the I Ching. And so she was weird because she was actually part Native American on top of it. She was a weird mix of a lot of different things, kind of like Buckaroo Banzai. And she was really interesting. And she was a theater girl on top of it. She went to the Seattle Academy of Arts and Sciences down in Seattle, Washington. So she went to a private arts and entertainment high school. And then, you know, we met in college, and for whatever reason, even though, you know, we were complete, you know, I was the, you know, eccentric jock and she was the, you know, this weird theater hybrid of a lot of different things, we really, really clicked. And we just were famous in college. We just, you know, couldn't do any wrong. We walked around like we owned the place. And it was a lot of fun and had a lot of great discussions and did so much stuff together. And yeah, it was volatile sometimes because we were both so passionate. But it was great. Really, really great.
All right. If you could go back in time.
Yeah.
What would you go see? What would you go do?
Would it have to be in my lifetime or any time if I had a time machine? Like, could I go back and see the pyramid? Yeah. Go back and
go
see
back
the pyramid?
As far as you want. Yep, go on.
Oh, okay. Well, no, it wouldn't be looking at my life. It would be if I had to, I already thought about this one many times because time travel is just fascinating for me anyway. I mean, there's so many things I want to go back and see. But it wouldn't be the obvious stuff. It would kind of be conspiracy based. You know, lots of people would be like, oh, I go back and see who actually shot JFK. It's like, oh, that's so pedestrian. No, you want to go back and see.
That's so small compared to what you could really go see.
Oh, you could see some really, really great stuff. But I would limit it to our civilization because anything that was before our civilization, there are those big gaps. And so you kind of lose relevance. So it's like, I'd go back and see Atlantis. It's like, yeah, but then what? You know,
if I had to do this, I think I'd go back and see how Earth was made.
Oh, I wouldn't go back that far. I'd make it more intimate. I would go back literally to the day when...
You'd go back and kiss that girl again.
No, I wouldn't. No. I'm not... No, nothing like that. I would go back, although that is great. No, that memory hopefully will never be taken from me. I would go back to when the pyramids were – I go back, let's say, 5,000 years to when the pharaohs first showed up, you know, when the first survey team went into what is now Cairo and saw the pyramids and, you know, or maybe the day before they show up, just so I could say, oh, okay, so the pyramids are here, but there's no city. Which means, you know, okay, how old are the pyramids really? You know, it would validate, you know, something I had suspected for a long time. And I would love to see that. It would just be a quick note of personal satisfaction. It's like, hey, the pyramids are here, but nobody else is here. Therefore, you know, all that crap about how the pharaohs built the pyramids and the Sphinx and all that other crap was just, you know, again, just rewriting history. And that's why I go back and see. Because that's about as far back as, you know, if I had to walk through time, that's where I would start my walk through time. I would go to that point and then go forward.
So overall, if you had to sum up your childhood, how would you do this? And did we leave out anything that you would like to uncover yourself?
No, because I've been so introspective over the years. And I've had a lot of time to think about stuff because I never got married or had kids. So I've had a lot of free time on my hands to really reflect on just about everything I've ever done. So no, as far as summing up my childhood, no, long stretches of blissful ignorance and being naive and, you know, thinking that nothing, you know, that the world was absolutely, you know, as it was presented to, and then changing from that into, Oh, okay. So everything was not what it was presented to me, which is why it's so easy for me to latch on to bigger concepts because I ran into that. So
okay, so I want to touch on a couple things before we break into the next segment. We only have about 7 minutes, so I want to kind of run through it real fast.
Go ahead.
You said that your mom was a church-going lady. At least that's the feel I got when you were talking about the deacon.
Yeah.
Okay. and you said that your dad, you have issues with your dad.
Yeah.
It's interesting that you mentioned this because I want to know what kind of religious ties you had as a child.
Born again Christian. Very, very born again Christian. Vacation Bible school during the summer, youth groups in the evenings and the Sundays, of course, Sunday worship, you name it. Any camps. I went to Camp Malibu up in Canada, which is a very, very Christian camp, one summer. Born again, I was saved, sometime during high school, and then fell away from that later. But yeah, growing up, absolutely very, very, went to the Christianary Missionary and Alliance Church, which is not, it's still there, but it's got a whole different pastor and a whole different congregation. But yeah, I went to the same church basically my whole life.
Okay. And what event? I know you were touching on it briefly while you were talking about your past, but yeah. What event, what specific event tore you and your father apart?
The merging, the thing that got to me wasn't that he left. And again, he left on very civil terms and was the family planned it to where, again, I was going to college. So it wasn't like I was going to be home seeing it. I felt bad for my sister. But, she always had boyfriends, so it wasn't that big a deal. But it was that the secretary he married already had three kids from another marriage. And they were younger than me. And he was trying to integrate those kids with my sister and me. And that was not going to work out. We were growing up. I grew up with a lot of loyalty. And so, it was one thing. It's like, it's one thing if you're going to leave. It's a whole nother thing, though, if you're going to push it, don't add insult to injury. And that was pretty much it for me. It was like, you made your decision. And with this move you made, that's what's, that's going to be the final straw for us.
So you kind of felt that he chose his new family over his old.
He tried.
There's no other
way
to put it.
Yeah, yeah. He tried to have his cake and eat it too, and that was still hang on to his relationship with his kids, and still have this relationship with these other kids, and sometimes you have to choose sides, and in this case I knew that he had sort of a track record, and my mom didn't, and so that was the side I chose. And,
okay.
Wasn't easy, but had to be done.
Okay, so we're going to wrap up the whole childhood segment.
Okay.
Mark, if you could right now sit and talk to your audience, is there anything that you feel you've left out that they should know? And the reason I say this is because your childhood is your past. And while people say your past isn't really that big of a deal, Or, when you talk to a new lover, they say, oh, don't worry about the past. The thing is, your past is what made you the type of person that you are today. So it's vital to understand that, to be able to understand Mark Sargent. So is there anything that you feel that at all that we have left out that maybe your audience should know to help other understand your movement or be done with it?
Not really, other than I'm loyal almost to a fault when it comes to causes and what I think is right, and so yeah, I'll put myself at some risk to accomplish a goal. And that's not always easy, but when you're kind of raised like that, dad was always big on, be the hero. That was one of his things. It's like, stand up for what's right, despite the odds, and go, go with what you feel in your heart, and don't do anything destructive if that's possible. And yeah, that's about it. The rest of the questions were great.
Okay, so we have about a minute left in our segment before it actually ends. Mark, you have an interesting childhood. you have a very interesting and unique intro perspective of who you are inside. So it's almost like you're well-founded. You know, your foundation is pretty strong. Now, you said you went to college, right?
Yeah.
Okay. We're going to touch on that in the next segment here. And I'm saying it all on the air, so there's no disclosure. You know, no one's hiding anything. No one's, you know, we're not going to, you know, go crazy. I mainly, again, like I said, wanted to do this because people need to know. And it will help them understand you. So we'll be back after these messages.
Humanist Story is the story of humanity, one person at a time. We believe each person has a story to tell, and each story shapes that person into who they are today. Collectively, and more importantly, each and every person's story shapes this little blue rock we call home. We are all together, whether we like it or not. We also believe that your unique story might just help someone else traveling down your pathway in life. You might be their guide through this rough time. We are always looking for more exciting stories to share with the world. If you've got one, come share it with us today.
We're here with Mark Sargent, talking on Humanastory Live Presents, and we are talking about Mr. Sargent, about his life in review. And we feel it's really important to be talking about this because, well, what kind of person is he? He's leading a band of people. We want to make sure he's a decent guy, right? I mean, that's how this works out. So, Christina, it's all yours. Take it away.
All right. So we have been accustomed to make this existence worthwhile by the belief that there is more than the outward appearance, that we live for a future beyond this life here, for example, heaven. For the outward appearance does not seem to make sense. If living is to end in pain, incompleteness, and nothingness, to make it seems cruel and futile experience for people who are born to reason, hope, create, and love. A human, as a being of sense, wants their life to make sense. And they find it hard to believe that it does so unless there is more than what he sees. Unless there is an eternal order or an eternal life beyond the uncertain and momentary experience of life and death. So with that said, Mr. Sargent, as an adult, what are your thoughts on religion, spirituality, or the hereafter?
I firmly believe in an afterlife. And even though I was raised, you know, very, not necessarily strict, but strong born-again Christian, that sort of developed and expanded when I got into college, like a lot of people. And I looked at the other religions. So I respect, you know, the big five, which control 80% of the population, which is Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, and Christianity. But even the big five religions wasn't enough for me, and I really started taking a hard look at the world. And I wrote something when I was in my late 20s called Static World. As a matter of fact, it was just kind of a thought process that I came up with, which really looked at the world from layers of conflict and saw that there was so much conflict in the world, inescapable conflict. Again, it doesn't matter how rich you are, how powerful you are, how beautiful you are. We all have things to complain about. I'll use Jean Paul Getty, the one of the early big money men in America, and he had a 110 room mansion. And most people don't know this. 110 room mansion, but he didn't like his guests. You know, because you can have a few guests if you have 100 rooms. He didn't like his guests making long distance phone calls. And so he installed payphones in the hallways of this giant mansion just to prove a point. And that you could tell it bugged him so much that he would actually lower the tone of this beautiful mansion by installing payphones. And you hear all sorts of weird eccentric stories about people that are rich or powerful or beautiful. And everyone's got, again, you can't there's so many, you always have something to complain about. And that screamed to me that, and I have absolutely no doubt that outside of this world, which is brief and, you know, full of misery and suffering and hardship, you know, at varying levels of pain and suffering, that we have an unlimited universe outside of that, that is full of joy and creativity and limitlessness. And that's what really inspires me to do so many different things. And so, yeah, that's what I think of now. And I have no doubt that the afterlife is a fantastic and wonderful thing. And for a lot of people, it's not what they expect.
What about when you were a child?
Child,
do you still think the same thing as you did when you were a child?
No, but that's because I was spoon-fed the New Testament, and the New Testament when I was younger. I was taught that, you know, if you were into Old Testament, you were outdated, and you know, the Catholicism wasn't great, and Judaism was bad. Basically, all the other religions were nothing compared to Christianity. And you know, when you grow up, when you're younger, you know, that's you believe what you're told. And but again, I asked a lot of questions. I was a creative problem solver, and there was a lot of, you know, I was not fun during Sunday school because I had questions, and that carried over, you know, into my later life. That and a lot of these questions I had to dig into for myself. So yeah, when I was younger, very, very different than what I have now.
Okay, so I want to touch on Wilbur Glenn Volva. You know, I really hate this dude's name.
Just say his first name. Yeah.
I'm going to call him Wilbur.
Yeah, there you go.
We'll call him Will. Willie. All right, so before I begin on Willie, I wanted to be noted, there's a lot of extreme religious connections involving the Flat Earth movement. Not only by the comments that others leave on YouTube's videos that are uploaded, but just about every Flat Earth channel you go to, people talk about religion left and right, as well as the references involved from your very own convictions in your own show segments, referring to the firmament, to the Tower of Babel. The reason that this concerns us is because we all know the connections to religion and its brainwashing past, from controlling kings to killing millions, to its violent current usage, such as the Middle East, and even child abuses like pedophilia. It goes on in churches. Look at the recent events with the Catholic Church and all the priests, and just look at what's going on over in the Middle East. Werber Glenn Volivia, Will, or Big Willie, from 1914, he gained a nationwide notoriety by his vigorous advocacy of the Flat Earth Doctrine. Some called him the Modern Flat Earther, or the Modern Flat Earth Father. He offered a widely publicized $5,000 challenge for anyone to disprove him in the Flat Earth Theory. And again, this $5,000 was in 1914. So you can see what kind of money he was throwing out. The church schools in Zion, Illinois, taught the Flat Earth Doctrine. And Zion is where he resided. So this is where he was really big. In 1923, he became the first evangelical preacher in the world to own his own radio station, which could be heard as far away as Australia. His radio station broadcast his diatribes against the round earth astronomy and the evils of evolution. Now, why it concerns us is because how does this tie in with your religious aspects? How does this tie in with you? And did you hear about this guy before you even started doing the Flat Earth segments? And because, again, everyone ties this in with religion. And we all know religion is not good. You know, there are aspects to spirituality which are good, but religion itself does not have a good history.
Okay.
That would concern anyone.
Yeah. No, I had never heard of this guy at all. In fact, I had almost no knowledge of anything that was involved in the Flat Earth when I first got into it. I mean, other than hearing the name, of course, you know, and you know, the old stories about the ships falling off the edge and crap like that. No. And really, the first time I think I even heard Flat Earth in any form of media was the Men in Black line, which we all know so well, where Tommy Lee Jones says, you know, 500 years ago, everyone knew the Earth was flat. But that being said, you know, when I went into it, as objective as I could, and even avoided just about every religious reference when I was building the clues, to the point where people were a lot, you know, because there's a lot of people involved in the five major religions, and everyone started hammering on me, sending a lot of emails saying, you've got to address religion. You've got to, you know, are they hiding God? Are they hiding intelligent design? To where I finally made a clue towards the end called, Hiding God. Which has now been mirrored and turned into like a mini movie out there, you know, called They Are Hiding God with the Greatest Lie Ever, and which I did not make. You know, I mean, yeah, I made the clues, but I didn't title it. I didn't put it up like that. And I didn't brand it as that. But no, religion had no, you know, was the last thing on my mind when I was making this. But I will say that there was enough people of different faiths that were putting that thought out there, which was, if they are hiding God, the people have a right to know. I said, yeah, you know what? It's a pretty good argument. I mean, they've been arguing about, you know, the argument about intelligent design versus non-intelligent design. And you know, it is the one of those burning questions that we all ask. And that is, you know, how did I get here? And, you know, if there was proof of it, wouldn't it be something that, you know, everyone would be concerned with? So, you know, I turned it into sort of like a, I didn't try to be dark with it. I just said, look, it's a message of hope. And that is, don't you want to know where you are? And that's where I, you know, kind of left it when I got to the end of the clues.
Okay. Now,
what?
The issues that I have with the whole subject of flat earth and religion, I mean, obviously they touch on the violence side of everything. I mean, everything you're seeing in the news is religious, you know, Muslim this, Muslim that. And it's not just Muslims. It's really, it really isn't. Look at the Crusades. I mean, you can go back in time a little bit. You know, people say, well, that was 200, 300 years ago. Who cares? Well, I do. When this movement is growing and these people are all religious, how do we know they're not going to start killing people? I mean, that's, you know, I'm not necessarily saying you're at fault for this. I mean, because obviously you didn't start the movement. If anyone did, it would have been Werber, Glenn, Volivia.
Oh, yeah, but, yeah. Nobody invented flat Earth.
So, I mean, the issues that I have revolve around the violent side of things. I mean, you just look at some of your comments on the YouTube channels that you put and you'd see them. I mean, yeah, they hide behind masks, but often what people first say is what they project about themselves onto other people.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're just, it's insulting. You know, if you're trying to get a scientific mind, people who are all about science, converted over to believing in flat earth. You've said it several times. I've tried to get Neil deGrasse Tyson on whatever the hell his name is. I'm trying to get him onto your show. Trying to get him on your show. How are you going to do that when everybody is spewing religion? No one wants to listen to his objective viewpoints. And, I mean, He honestly wouldn't even step foot in your arena because he already knows it's a losing battle, not because of your facts, but because of the people involved.
Yeah, the crowd definitely wouldn't be with him. That's for sure. I mean,
so what do you hope to gain?
Well,
if this is the crowd that we're dealing with,
because this is going to sound oversimplified, but it's the best I got at the moment. That is, the ends will justify the means, meaning, and I tried to talk about this at one of the end clues, and that is, if people can be as mean as they want up until the point where they know that there's someone looking over their shoulder, and by that I mean, if this is proof of intelligent design, and I'm not necessarily saying the handprint of God, although there's going to be a lot of people that will say that. If this becomes revealed, and I really believe it'll be a point of when, then everyone that's lashing out and swinging in the dark, they're going to have to take a hard look at themselves and say, because I did, I put it out there, I asked them, I said, are you really, forget about wars and racism and sexism and all these other things, those things will go away to a certain extent. Will you do anything malicious if you know that you have, for lack of a better word, a parental figure looking over your shoulder? If that's the case, will you actually be doing, will you make the same decisions that you were going to do in the first place? I don't think, and I remember, I'm a glass half full. You know, I'm the optimist. I grew up with light and you know, a sense of optimism. So I think that people will, yeah, they'll begrudgingly do it. They'll be like, you know, they'll look over there, they'll look up at the sky, they'll realize what's going on, and then they'll say, all right, I get it. I'm, you know, I won't, you know, I'm not going to, you know, are you really going to keep doing those things? I would hope that people won't. Now, of course, the psychopaths probably still will. But even, you know, your the people that have, you know, we want to call them zealots, will they go down that path? I don't know. But I think it's a chance that we should be willing to take. And that is, it's not just a message of hope. It's a warning more than anything. It's like, look, we're heading for the precipice. We have all seen it. It's a, you know, we're in a slow motion skid going off the cliff. And this thing, even though it wouldn't stop it entirely, would be a hard left turn or a hard right turn away from it at the very least. You know, will there be some growing pains along the way? Absolutely, there will be. Like with any paradigm shift, there's going to be some people dragged kicking and screaming into this thing. But you know, and most of them will be these angry people with horrible childhoods. And I feel bad. I am sorry about that, that you don't want your world to change. And I'm sorry that you're going to be resisting this thing. But if it changes, if it goes the way that I think it is, then we actually do become a big community, you know, one big family. And are you going to attack or your roommates? Are you really going to slug it out with your roommates? If you're the only one, you know, at that point, do we have a common goal? It may be temporary, you know, until, you know, things settle in, but I think it's got a shot. I really do. And I wouldn't keep doing it if I didn't believe that. This isn't a thing about power. As you know, I'm not trying to monetize anything. You know, I'm just putting it out there. Whatever kind of talked to me, you know, back in February and had me do this, you know, I'm the first one to say it didn't necessarily come from me. You know, I woke up with the narrative in my head and you know, typed it all down and put this stuff together, even though I'd really never built a decent YouTube video in my life. and put it out there thinking it was going to get smushed. I thought I was going to get so many emails from like physicists and scientists and say, you are absolutely dead wrong, and here's why. And here we are a year later, coming up on a year, you know, in a couple more weeks. And the questions that I put out there, they're still resonating. And I get emails, these wonderful emails every week from men and women from all walks of life that say the same thing. It's like, look, eyes opened. I'm in, you know, and there's, everyone feels so optimistic.
So. It is hard. It's hard to ignore the facts. You know, one of the facts that I, like I was saying is, you know, we'll touch on, a little more in depth later, but you know, we were talking about, Stent Freeman is one of the people that was on your show, but it doesn't just stop there. Like some of these conspiracies that a lot of people come up with, are being produced by, you know, you look at Cat Williams, you know, really big famous actor, and it's not just famous people, it's smart people saying the same thing. I mean, one of the authors of one of the books that I read, he definitely does not believe in this conspiracy crap, but does he believe in a new world order? Yes. Why? Because after World War II, they had to get together to say, hey, how can we solve the problems of the world after that, you know? But it doesn't stop there. I've seen people like Prince on TV. I just showed Christina one of the videos on Prince talking about how he said before President Washington, there were 8 more presidents before him.
Yeah.
I mean, and you're listening to this and you're going, these are people that are supposed to be leading the population. Why are they saying what they're saying? They have the money. They're in the know. Hell, even Donald Trump has been on Alex Jones, and Alex Jones' show is a conspiratorial show. The next president of the United States is willing to stick his neck out on a show with conspiracy theorists. What does that say? You can't ignore these facts. And I get lost. So I'm going to fall back on what I originally was talking about. How do you feel about Werber Glenn Volov, whatever the hell his name is? God, I hate you. I hate you.
I, do, I don't even really have an opinion on him, to be honest.
But he's considered the modern flat earth father. I mean, he stormtrooped this into what it is today. At least that's from what I understand. So what do you think?
If he tied to religion, that's one thing. I mean, I don't think he could have ignored it. Orlando Ferguson, who was really one of the older guys in his map, the flat and stationary earth, which I really liked because it was a really cool map, which it kind of shows the earth kind of not perfectly flat, but like a hubcap, I would say roulette table. But now we all know that all the numbers in the roulette table add up to 666, which is really weird. So I'm not supposed to say that anymore. But and he put four angels on the corners, you know, and talk.
Okay, I got to touch on that. Why are people so, like, we were talking about that like the other day about Masonics, and not to cut you off on this.
That's fine.
And I've done my best to not cut you off. But this is a question that's been burning in the back of my head. If you hold your hands a certain way, if you blink the wrong way, if you fart in a chair the wrong way, people think you're in league with the devil. So I don't, I mean, come on, are intelligent people that are really looking at your videos this stupid to honestly think that you, because you blinked the wrong way, to discredit you completely because you sneezed and farted at the same time?
People are really hypersensitive about that stuff, and I've been very, very careful up until that thing with Sasha. Why are they hypersensitive about it? Because for the last, and I know you haven't been as deep into conspiracies as other people.
I'm not. I mean, we generally at Humanastory don't feel that humanity is so evil that they want to wipe every single person off the planet and then shit on your grave. I mean, I don't.
There have been a lot of documentaries, mostly YouTube stuff, that have been put out in the last, 10 years, that have covered just about every celebrity, actor, movie stars, television stars, musical artists especially. You know, it started out with the whole heavy metal Satan
stuff. Let me rephrase this. I'm not saying, I don't want to cut you off, but I'm not saying that there isn't a conspiracy out there. I mean, people like Prince, Donald Trump, who's the leading runner for Republicans for the presidential seat, is saying, yes, this shit is out there. So, I mean, you're talking about, like I said, Stanton Friedman. I mean, if you could get any other people that are involved deeply into schools, it's all over. It's all over. It doesn't matter what your job is or what your education level is. It's obviously so many people saying the same thing, something's got to be true. But I mean, to flat out say because you drank your coffee with your left hand, well, that's a Masonic symbol and the world has to go to hell now, you know, we can't watch your videos. I don't understand where they're connecting A and B.
They're microscoping everything and they're looking for anything suspicious.
Stop right there. They're looking for anything, which brings up to mind, the second you go looking for something, you're going to find what you're looking for if you look hard enough.
Sure.
Right? So, I mean, at what point? Okay, so I'm going to get way off on our thing here. Let me, we'll touch on this because it's coming up. What I want to ask right now is what changed in this thought process as a result of growing up? And the original question we asked you was, do you believe the same thoughts in religion as you did when you were a child? You said no. What changed?
Just got older. Mostly college than anything. Again, you know, if you're sheltered.
Education?
Yeah, it was education and being exposed to a lot of things. You're exposed to, you know, the political system and, you know, different religions and different ideas. I mean, you're exposed to a lot of different ideas. What was that great saying? And I can't remember if it was Family Guy or American Dad, where he goes, there's a time and a place for everything. And that place is college. Because we all experiment with just about everything that's possible in college. And in fact, I go so far to say, because, you know, people say, well, you had an illegal fireworks company in college. I'm going, man, look, if you weren't getting in trouble in college, then you weren't trying. Because that is where you want to just cut loose and you get in a lot of trouble, you know, because your parents aren't there and you get to cut loose. And so, yeah, that was basically.
Okay, so listen, we're going to cut onto a break real quick and then we'll come right back.
Humanist Story is the story of humanity, one person at a time. We believe each person has a story to tell, and each story shapes that person into who they are today. Collectively, and more importantly, each and every person's story shapes this little blue rock we call home. We are all together whether we like it or not. We also believe that your unique story might just help someone else traveling down your pathway in life. You might be their guide through this rough time. We are always looking for more exciting stories to share with the world. If you've got one, come share it with us today.
We're talking about the present, and I wanted to know, what is your family like now as an adult versus when you were a child?
Different. I haven't spoken to my father in a number of years. He currently lives, I think, in Arizona. I can't actually remember now. It's been a while. We haven't talked since my sister's wedding back in the early 90s.
Do you ever plan to talk to him again?
The what?
Do you ever plan to talk to him again?
Probably not. You know, we've gotten to that point where, you know, there's no surprises here. You know, he made his decision and he's going to live with it. And again, I'm a big believer in, you know, consequences. And, you know, I know lots of people, you know, in fact, I've gotten flack from that from friends, you know, who have said, oh, you know, it's family and that's, you know, you're supposed to forgive certain things. And it's like, no. You can forgive certain things. I've never exactly done what other people do. And I believe, you know, I've got that whole hero mentality going where, you know, I believe in justice on a permanent level. And so, not really in contact with dad. Mom, I'm still in contact with. My sister, not as much, but we were never exactly close. She and I were very, very, very different, you know, to the point where, you know, we just never saw eye to eye on just about anything, which was interesting considering how close we were in age. But everybody else, yeah, pretty standard, you know, grandparents, uncles, aunts, that sort of stuff. Everybody's still around. Most of them are in the Northwest. So,
all right. So now that you're all grown up and you're more seasoned to life, do you feel that you have accomplished your childhood goals as an adult?
Yeah, just about almost all, with the exception of one, just about. And again, because I was encouraged to chase my dreams, just about everything I ever wanted to do, I got to do. So I got to, you know, do fireworks for a living, even though it was illegal. I got to play computer games for a living, which was a whole ton of fun. Mm-hmm. I got to, just do a lot of little things, but yeah, I accomplished just about everything. The only thing I didn't get to accomplish was, I didn't own a gun shop. Believe it or not, that was one of my goals.
Really?
I thought, well, I grew up during the assault weapons craze of the 80s.
Well, since you mentioned it, not me, I want to know your thoughts on this gun control. And I know that I was talking to you guys on one of your previous shows, you and Patricia, and it came across his executive order. So our president came out with an executive order. And what I was referring to is you probably hadn't watched the news at that time, which is why you guys were like, what is he talking about? Can he rephrase his question? The question that I was asking was in regards to gun control. He signed an executive order to either ban, limit. I don't remember what that executive order was or when he did it, but it was all over the news. And it had to do with gun control.
Sure. It was mostly regarding background checks, and it really doesn't make any difference. I mean, he's just doing what he can do now because he's getting pressure from Mayor Bloomberg out of New York. My opinion on gun control and is kind of different from your standard pro-gun people, which is, you know, every time Obama starts saying that he's going to make legislation, gun sales go up. You know, they go through the freaking roof. People line up and they buy stuff. But what people don't realize is that since the assault weapon stuff really started in the early 80s and continued all the way into the 90s, I mean, I used to go to gun shows in the 90s before they started clamping down those things. Really what happened was it's not the gun owners right now that's really the big influence, which they're not focusing. It's the manufacturers more than anything. Let me be blunt. There are so many guns in this country. And I'm not trying to be defeatist towards, you know, the left wing or anything, but there's so many firearms in this country. You will never get rid of them all.
Well,
there's,
you know, my whole point behind the whole thing is yeah. Look, guns have been around since what, the 7th century?
Yeah.
They're not going anywhere. And furthermore, no. Why are we blaming guns for a human condition?
Cuz you got to blame it on somebody.
That's the thing. Guns are not even the issue. Look, I don't own a gun. My brother is a cop. He owns guns left and right. He thinks the world's going to come to an end, and he believes thoroughly that he needs to stock up and be ready for everything.
Sure.
But my issues on the whole subject are not with the gun control, but the people. Like, they want to blame guns for a human condition. Well, it's guns. I can kill you with a knife. I can kill you with a car. I can strike you with lightning. I mean, there's a million things I can do. Why are we...
Because guns are tied to, you know, more of your mass shootings, and I don't want to go into what's real and what's not.
I mean, no, I know. That's the whole purpose. I wasn't going to talk about conspiracies.
You got to pin it on something concrete, you know, something tangible, something that's easy, and something corporate, something that you can actually control. You can't control psychological disorders. Well, I mean, you can, but you're, you know, but you don't know when the next person's going to flip out. There's nothing else to go after except for guns, but unfortunately it's just not going to happen. The manufacturers, the American manufacturers of firearms are
on the realm of conspiracy. Do you think that the manufacturers of guns are trying to create this turmoil? So the second the president gets on and says, oh, 9 black people in a church were shot, not saying they weren't shot, but let's say he gets on TV and says they are.
Yeah.
Everyone runs out and buys guns because, well, now we need to talk about guns, and that'll, you know, let's lock them down.
The manufacturers,
is it possible there?
No,
backing it?
No. The manufacturers, I mean, yeah, they want to make money, of course.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I mean, I could make a crap ton of money if I make you think that the world's going to come to an end, and if you don't buy your guns now, it's over.
They're not going to dissuade people from that idea. You know, the gun manufacturers aren't going to come out and say, hey, you know, there's nothing to worry about. You know, they're going to sit back and watch the people buy their stuff. But again, the manufacturers, there's too many of them with military contracts, and there's too many of them that figured out to selling to civilian markets. In the movies they were a huge contributor to this whole thing, which is why, you know, there was, I mean, look back, you know, I hate to blame it on Clint Eastwood, but he started the whole thing. I mean, that silly speech he did, you know, you fire 6 shots or only 5, you know, being this is a Smith & Wesson 44 mag. He didn't say Smith & Wesson, but being this is a 44 mag, the world's most powerful handgun, will take your head clean off. That monologue right there sold so much. I mean, you know, you couldn't keep those things on the shelves. And then, you know, other manufacturers figured, you know, it didn't take a genius to figure out what was going to happen next. And here we are now, and anything that's in the military market, there's a civilian model for it. They're just not going away. So, you know, everyone that sees a headline and they go out and they buy stuff, you don't have to, because they are never going house to house and taking the guns. They can't.
I thought that. I seriously thought that, except I live in California, and just recently they passed an order where principals are walking around with a sheriff and a nurse knocking on doors telling people, your child needs to be vaccinated. If he's not, he's going to be truant. And if he's truant, I'm going to have to arrest you because you're the parent of that child not in school. And they're literally, it's on the news now.
Okay. I mean, I'll give you that. But vaccinations is
Wait, what did you say?
vaccinations.
No. You'll give me that?
Yeah, I'll give you that. I mean, it's a good comparison, but it's still not guns. You know, it's taking something away. I mean, there's a far cry than from saying, you know, oh, you know, you got to have your children vaccinated to saying, okay. Oh, by the way, I'm taking all your guns.
That no, you're right. 100%. You're right. Except for one thing.
What?
I do it to vaccines. Then I do it to guns. Then I do it to your free speech.
Yeah, and I see where you're going with that. Sure.
What was that?
I see. Wait, I see the chain. I see that.
Okay.
But I'm telling you, from a logistical standpoint, it is going to be so unbelievable. Plus, you're going to have think of this. Even if you thought about going down that road, you know, as far as a government trying to do that, the corporations that are involved, and I'll just name off just a small handful of American corporations, you know, small ones like Winchester, Remington, Ruger, Beretta, Smith & Wesson. These guys would go out of their freaking minds and lobby any action you were thinking of doing into the ground because they're a cult.
shows how corrupt everything really is. Because
it is at the highest level. So, but what I'm saying is at the gun manufacturers actually, you know, people say, oh no, the NRA has our back. No. The gun manufacturers have your back because that's where the money is. So they will personally, they have a personal stake in it. They will stop the house to house stuff. And I know some people say, no, they might come. It's like, it is way tougher than you think.
I see what you're saying. So you're saying the corporations are going to back you. They're going to back the people because they want to sell the guns.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It will not take them that long. I mean, they've got deep pockets and very lucrative military contracts. And they've got, they've got a lot of guns. And you do not want to make it to the point where all of a sudden, you know, how long, you know, if they push back and the corporations don't allow them, how long before those corporations start letting things seep out and then becomes a whole bootlegging thing from the Prohibition days again? Only this time with guns. Then it gets, then it gets ugly. You know, then you've got, you know, everything's black market. Ooh.
All right, so let's get back on track. I was just curious because you had mentioned guns in a previous episode, and I wanted to know what you thought about them now.
Sure, let's
talk about what you're doing now, and then I'm going to let the co-host do all the rest of the questions here.
Sure. Oh, what am I doing now?
Yep. What are you doing now?
Are you going to talk about
growing
it
up, college? Well, yeah, I guess. No. Oh, okay, growing up, did you go to college, technical
school? Yes, I did. I went 1 year at Washington State.
Wait, you're all right, never mind. You still got some time. Go ahead.
Okay, 1 year at Washington State, 3 years at Western Washington University until I was thrown out for manufacturing.
Why were you thrown out?
Legal fireworks company on campus. I was officially the charge.
You know, if you were doing that now, you'd be considered a terrorist. I bet
oh,
you.
Oh yeah. $100. Oh god. I could never do it now. Oh man, the things I did. Officially the charge was manufacturing explosives without a license. Which is even makes some way worse.
You'd
but it was
be,
all
you'd
fine.
Be in a prison being waterboarded right now.
Thank you. Yeah, because it's a federal charge. It's not fun. But it's fireworks, and it was it was in the early 90s when I got smacked for it, and so it wasn't that. Yeah, but had that happened after 2001, we wouldn't be speaking. So
yeah, we'd be behind bars.
Yeah, yep. I even had a competitor that actually went in, but hey, that's another story for another time.
Yeah. So. All right, so the co-host is going to take over from here. All
right, so we know that you have your radio shows and things like that. So what do you do officially for a living?
Right now, nothing. Mm-hmm. I do this, and I'm looking to turn it into something. Part of the reason why, because I've been shopping my resume around and looking for, tech support.
You
stuff.
Better not forget us little people.
I will not forget little people. But there's been so many little feelers from different groups that, again, people are trying to think of a way to monetize this. I mean, there's been talk about, a flat earth reality show and some sort of conspiracy thing. And it's cool, and that's great. I have been not shy about telling people. I was like, look, if I get an offer to do that sort of thing, that's what I'm going to do. if it comes my way. But that's what I'm kind of hoping. I mean, this thing has grown and resonated into something that I never thought it would be. So that's what I'm really hoping to turn it into something right now. So that's where I am. I'm in this weird flat earth limbo as we speak.
So it's safe to say that you're happy what you're doing.
Yeah, surprisingly.
You know, one of the books that I was reading, it's by a gentleman by the name of Alan Watt, and I would actually look him up and read some of his stuff. He says, you know, if you could forget about money, if you could forget about the price of things,
yeah,
what would you do?
Was that my question?
Yep.
If I absolutely could do anything I wanted right now, well, beforehand,
no,
be...
and there's no money. There's no money involved in it.
Oh, play video games for, you know, profession. I'd go back to what I was doing. I'd you know, go to conventions and play games. It was that was a pure joy, what I was doing, because I've played so many games over the years, and that's what I would do. This just kind of came upon me. But yeah, if I had to do something again, I'd go back and do what I was doing, you know, in the mid to late 90s, which was, you know, especially when the gaming world was just getting its legs. It was so much fun, and the people were great, and it was fantastic. I mean, yeah, I was hanging out with a whole ton of nerds but I got to learn that whole world very, very quickly.
So, do you feel as a kid you would be even remotely close to doing what you're doing now professionally?
Oh, no. I mean, not just a kid. I mean, I wasn't kidding. You could have asked me in the beginning of 2014.
I bet you did. At some point, at some level, you were looking up at the sky when you were laying flat on your back. Remember that phrase?
Yes.
You were looking up, wondering what was out there. Bet you.
Yeah, but I would have never thought for a second that it was that intimate. That it wasn't this, you know, because we're all raised to, you know, learn about the solar system and all these massively vast distances and how small we are in the universe. And then it turns out, you know, at least by the stuff that I'm talking about now, that it's the exact opposite. That everything, you're right there, and you're way more relevant and way more special, and everything's much more intimate, and the stars are yours, and the sun and the moon are yours, and yours alone. And it's a fantastic thought process to get into. Again, it's why people get so excited. But no, I would have never in a million years thought that that's this would. I mean, again, I've said this before. Of all the conspiracies, because people say, "Oh, you're trying to do disinfo, and you're trying to, you know, take things away from other conspiracies." Like, really, you think that I actually went out to seek out Flat Earth? It's the worst conspiracy ever of all time. It's the most laughable, most ridiculed. And again, it shows you how brilliant it is. Because why, out of all the conspiracies, I mean, because there's a bunch of doozies out there. You know, again, the lizard people one is a great one to bring up. It's like, oh yeah, you know, that all royalty are actually reptilians. People actually buy that before they buy Flat Earth. And you gotta wonder why. It's because, you know, why people in the forums get so upset. And why, you know, why some of the trolls just lose their minds, you know, to where they get inspired to make videos against it. Not just put stuff in comments, but to sit down in front of a camera. You can always tell that it's a brand new channel.
Well, we're gonna touch on a couple of those people. That's why go ahead and ask the next question, Christina.
Do you have any side hobbies as an adult?
I burned through most of my hobbies. That was the other thing I got to do, was own a comic book shop. So yeah, in college I got a lot of that stuff out of my system really, really easy, really, really quickly. So when I was in college, I was running a legal fireworks operation, and I owned a comic book shop, and I ran one of the food services. And I was dating pretty much a crazy person.
So MacGyver.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. So yeah, my hobbies, I've gone through most of my hobbies. I collected every comic book thing I ever wanted to collect. I collected a whole bunch of antiques. I collected just weird little, I loved collecting knickknacks and some antique toys and some modern toys and just all sorts of fun stuff. I mean, I burned through most of all of them now, to where I really haven't been keeping up with that. Now I'm solely focused on the flat Earth thing, and the hobbies I've gone through them. I mean, I used to sailboard a lot. I used to play a lot of basketball. I used to do a lot of outdoor activities, a lot of hiking, you know, boating, you name it. I was into it. Fireworks. I've gone through all my hobbies. I've lived a lifetime of hobbies in a very short amount of time.
All right. So the next question is, what are you most proud of to this day with what you've done from childhood until now?
Your greatest achievement.
My greatest achievement. All right. Well, not counting what I'm hoping to accomplish with this thing, which is, you know, try to change the world. My greatest achievement was...
Well, technically, this isn't an achievement yet because you haven't done it.
I haven't done it. I think the most fun I had, the coolest achievement I think I had was winning the first computer pinball world tournament back in 1994, which kind of got my foot in the door as far as playing games for a living. But I did it by not cheating necessarily, but I kind of did it through like time travel, which was kind of weird. I figured out the algorithm that they use to encrypt the scores. So when you got a high score on your machine, you know, this is back when modems were around, you got to send in your score to the company that was doing the tournament. And I figured out that the algorithm was based off of, because I couldn't figure out, you know, the weird formula he was using, but they were using a time date stamp at the computer. And so I kept changing the time date stamp so that I didn't have to throw away these really, really good scores. So basically I had played the entire, and the tournament ran for a full calendar year. So I played the entire year in a span of, I don't know, 4 weeks. And I saved all the scores. And so when a month would come up, I would send in my April and then my May and then my June. And every month, you know, I'd save a higher and higher score. So I won the tournament. I didn't just win the tournament. I won the tournament 6 months before it even ended, and nobody knew. Geez. And so and because of the tournament, I got to, you know, the company, you know, I got to meet the developer out of Japan, and then the production company out of Colorado, and, you know, they brought me in, and I became the ringer, and everything from there. But it was so satisfying to win, because I actually did play the game and I did play those scores, and I did win the tournament. But I didn't want to make it a horse race. I hate that. So you know, through creative problem solving, I solved that dilemma, which was I figured out a way to play the tournament way ahead of time, and then I could just kind of do what I wanted for the rest of the year. And because really playing a tournament for an entire year, that's tough to do. So yeah, that was my proudest achievement, because it was kind of on the sly, but it was still perfectly legit. And I never did tell the people that you know, the company's long gone now. But I never did tell the president, because he absolutely would have just lost his mind at the company.
I bet he would.
Yeah, he would have been like, oh yeah, by the way.
So looking on the opposite side of that, what is your worst failure?
Worst failure would have been the fireworks.
We had Humanastory try to hit you hard.
That's okay. No,
going deep. Sorry.
No, the worst failure would have been the fireworks operation that I was running in college. When I was making all this stuff, there was a girl that shows you, you just have to learn by doing. There was a girl that worked for me who was very passionate. She was very focused, and she wanted to work for me for the entire summer. The girlfriend that I had at the time was very jealous that she, you know, this girl was very, very pretty. My girlfriend did not like her even being part of this operation, so she told me to get rid of her. And when I did, she said that if you do this, she goes, I was planning on making this money for the summer. If you do this, I'm going to drop the dime on you. Call the authorities. I'm just going, no, you won't. Right. I didn't take her seriously. You know, never underestimate somebody, you know, especially the, you know, hell hath no fury, you know, like of a woman scorned. And I'll be darned. You know, I found out later that absolutely she called them, and, you know, she called the FBI, who routed them to the ATF. And they completely ignored her because she was just some college girl. You know, it was like, you know, this guy's making fireworks in college. They paid no attention to her whatsoever. And then 2 weeks later, I'm walking around on campus, and she calls them again and says, look, clowns, why is this guy still walking around? He's making fireworks. There's like 30-something people working here on campus for him. And finally, they wrote my name down, and it all went south after that. But it was that was my greatest disappointment because I could have stopped it. Who knows what would have happened after that? You know, I could have, you know, paid her out, or, you know, just kept her on the payroll on the side or something. Right. I just, you know, you gotta, sometimes you gotta, you know, when people say what, you know, what they're gonna do. Now, most of the time, you know, you think it's hyperbole. It's like, you know, I'm gonna drop the dime on you. It's like, whatever. But in this case, yeah, she actually did. And I felt bad. The joke ended to be her in the end though, and I didn't know it. Again, me being so naive, because I ran into her, like, you know, shortly after I got in trouble with the government, and I went to her for kind of like for consolement, you know, because I knew her. It's like, oh, it's really bad, you know they took everything, and, you know, people got busted and stuff, and she was looking at me like I was a ghost, and she was so unbelievably terrified that I was in her place. Like that I knew. Basically, she thought that I knew the entire time and I was there to kill her.
When people do bad things,
yeah.
When people do bad things, guilt eats people. Oh, like, yeah. You know, paranoia just starts taking over.
Yeah. But she, like, pushed me out of the place, and I had no idea. It's like, why would she rush me out so much? It wasn't until months later when the feds told me who it was. It's like, oh, now I get it. So, yeah,
so, that was great. I wanted to ask you a question. You remember that 3-hour kiss?
It's hard to forget a 3-hour kiss, but yes.
Okay. What passions do you have now? Have you had any adult loves? You know, 3 hours.
Yeah. I've kind of hit and miss. What happened was when I got to Colorado.
When we're talking about sex and love, I don't think you want to say hit and miss.
Okay, well, no. It's okay. When I got to Colorado, what started happening was, and, you know, you got to be in kind of a certain situation to do that, and that is once you start getting, if you're not married by your late 20s, you start running into something unusual, and that is, especially if you're going to stay in your same age group, and that is you start running into people that are married. You know, people that are, the saying I like is men cheat because they can, but women cheat because they feel like they've earned it. And I really ran into that, you know, my late 20s into my early 30s, where a lot of the people that I was running into were already married. I mean, not like married and divorced, but like still married. And I was hearing a lot of the same old stories, you know, love lost and he isn't the man I married and that sort of thing. And I kind of, you know, it kind of soured me to that. So, no, I really haven't run into, I mean, yeah, I've dated here and there, but nothing serious, you know, for quite a while. I mean, you know, most of my great loves and great passions were, in college or shortly after college. And, they were really, really great. But again, you know, the demographics changed, and I wasn't, you know, the type to go in for, you know, just keep dating. Like, you know, I get older, but I keep dating, you know, women in their 20s or something like that. That wasn't me, because, you know, I like a certain, you know, the person to at least be on the same time frame that I am. If that's the right way of saying it, not like spiritual development or anything like that, but, you know, that they're at least in sync with the same, you know, events that may or may not have happened in their life. At least they're aware of it if they didn't experience it themselves. So.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. Anything else?
Well, yeah, she's supposed to be asking the questions, but I think she forgot.
So, well, overall, if you had to sum up your adulthood, how would you do that? What would you say to us? Is there anything that we left out that you want to add?
Only that what I am doing now, I am doing because, I have stopped fighting where the world wants to take me. Yeah, the world has guided me in certain places like a track, like a car on an amusement ride track, where you can kind of steer one way or the other, but that track, you're still not going to be able to break free of it. And that's where I am now. I'm where I am now. I have no doubt that that's what I'm supposed to be doing. So that's what I'm doing.
So, Mark, mm-hmm. right or wrong aside,
yeah.
While you gain traffic and your audience grows in size, do you ever ask yourself, am I doing the right thing?
Yes.
Let us use, for example, being right.
Okay.
Let's say right now, the governments of the world open up and suggest to all of humanity the world is indeed flat because of something miraculous, some fact that you've uncovered. And you are sitting in your room with that I told you so expression on your face, like everyone does when they've accomplished what they were trying to do. But now you stand in front of a mirror and you're self-reflecting. Meanwhile, now, I did see your interview or your talk or whatever you want to call it with this Tim Osman guy.
Mm-hmm.
And meanwhile, I'll get to him in a minute, but meanwhile, millions, if not billions, have been turned topsy-turvy. People are indeed killing themselves because the rapture has come and the murders are on the street. Men, women, children are now dead and the world is in utter chaos as a result. And then again, maybe not. Maybe this is a perfect world and people are ready to hear the truth. But let's take a look at how perfect we actually are living in right now, you know, with our times. Is it wise to smash it open in this way? And could you live with the blood on your hands, whether you think it is or not? You know, whether you believe that this blood is on your hands or not is irrelevant. After all, it would be your name associated with the unveiling and your truth that opened up and started the process. Remember when I referred to the Salem witch trials at the very beginning of this?
Mm-hmm.
Let's return to that and two incidences that I am aware of in just my tiny journey of understanding the big picture. Explain your thoughts on the incident with Tim Osman, who he is, and why he's harassing you now.
Oh, okay.
But let's go back before you do that. Let's talk about, do you ever ask yourself, are you doing the right thing?
Yeah, but I don't think it's much a dilemma as, like, say, the scientists that were deciding whether or not to develop the hydrogen bomb versus...
All right, so you got my point of view.
yeah, I got it. Right. Because, you know, they were doing it because science always goes down the road of, can it be done?
Okay. My reasoning behind this, my reasoning is a real serious and a real one. Mm-hmm. I live in San Diego, and when Hale-Bopp Comet came around, 28 people committed suicide believing that the Lord is coming on Hale-Bopp Comet. And I could imagine that there's this many people following the movement. So let's say that you open it up.
Yeah.
How dangerous this can really be. You know?
Yeah.
I'm not talking like Tim Osman. What I'm talking about now is... I've seen it firsthand out here in La Jolla, San Diego, in a mansion, 28 people covered themselves and killed themselves thinking this very thought process.
Yeah.
And so I ask if you ever actually think you're doing the right thing or not.
I absolutely have thought about this at great lengths, believe it or not. Jonathan and I have talked about this because he brought up actually the same train of thought you did. And that is, do you want to be responsible for the chaos if it goes south? And I said, if it is done right, and this isn't a cop-out on my part, if it is done right, and I have, you know, I won't necessarily talk about it on air tonight, but I believe if it is handled in a specific way and spun in a positive enough light or done in a, you know, a certain way that it won't turn as ugly as people think it is. Now, yes, will there be some instability? Yeah, of course there will. But I think the sheer awe of it, the shock and awe of it, will freeze people in their tracks to where they will have this weird sense of wonder, and that will give them the pause that they need instead of, you know, immediately start breaking open shops and, you know, killing their neighbors and doing all this stuff. If it is done right. If it goes south, will I feel absolutely terrible? You know, sure, of course I will. But it is not, you know, I still believe that humanity has it inside them, even though every indication out there is that they will make the wrong decision. I think humanity has it inside them to rise above it and turn this potentially into a new golden age. And really, what choice? What choice do I have? If we don't do something, we're headed to, you know, the abyss anyway. So for me, there really was no choice. I thought about it. I was like, look, you're either the devil that you know versus the devil that you don't know. And I've always been a big believer of choosing the devil you don't know, because you don't know. It could turn out to be a wonderful thing. What's the old 70s game show? Let's make a deal. Do you keep what you got now, or do you go for what's behind the curtain? And I like the curtain. I like the odds. And I think if it's done well enough, it can work.
Okay. So explain in your thoughts again. We're going to go back down to what I was talking about.
Yeah.
Explain your thoughts on the incident with Tom Osman.
Tim.
Who he is, yeah, and why he's harassing you.
Well, it was somewhat unusual because he, you know, for a troll, you know, a self-proclaimed troll, he broke one of the first rules of trolldom, which is, do not go out of your way to try to expose yourself, you know, if, you know, to whoever you're trying to harass. And I get it. You know, I don't respond in the forums, I mean, for several reasons. But, you know, he called me and left a message. And, you know, Tim Osman isn't his real name, of course. You know, trolls never use their real name. That's the whole point. You stay anonymous. But, you know, I figured when I called him, it's like, you know what? He actually went out of his way to do this. And his voice, you know, sounded a little, you know, like he was stretching for it. He seemed sort of apprehensive about calling me.
See, it seemed to me when I was listening to it, he had anger in him. And yeah. I mean, real anger. So it was, that's why he went out of his way to call you. This is what I was saying is they hide behind a mask. At the very beginning of all of this, I had mentioned to you that they hide behind a mask. And to me, that's hypocritical. It's very cowardly.
But it was the first time I had seen that with a troll. You know, most 99.5% of my emails are really positive and my phone message. This was the equivalent of a homeless guy that you just see, you know, outside of your car window. Open up your car door and grab you by the shoulder and shake. It's like, look at me, I am talking to you. And it's like, really? All right, what's on your mind? And, you know, so he and I had this discussion, and did I know he was going to record me? No. You know, but at the same time, and people said, well, you know, that's illegal. You know, you can get him for recording. And I was going, yeah, but here's the thing. Had he asked me if I could record this call, which other people have done anyway, and turned it into an interview, I would have said yes. And plus, you know, things get replicated so fast on the internet. I wasn't going to chase that recording around. I mean, he was already going to start shopping this thing and sending it to other people that he knew. And on top of that, I got to cover my own butt. You know, I treat anyone that talks to me like, at the very least, they're going to use a quote out of context or anything like that. So I treat everything like it's recorded. I don't, so that's why I didn't swear, I didn't call him names, I didn't do anything that might really, really antagonize him. And, you know, I thought, you know, at one point, you know, we got our points across to each other and we parted ways. And then he started microscoping the whole thing, and that's fine. I'll address what I can, you know, on Patricia's show later. Maybe. But It is what it is. And honestly, I didn't feel bad. It wasn't like one of those things because I was on another interview and I got an email from a woman named Robin Poe. And she goes, by the way, I enjoyed your video with that troll. And I wrote her back. I go, wait, he recorded that? And she goes, yes. And then she started sending me legal precedents and, you know, and how I could go after him. And I was, oh, man. But even when I saw that, I mean, the second, you know, I realized that there was a video on there, I didn't have this weird feeling in the pit of my stomach. It's like, oh, my God, what did I say? Did I say something horrible or, you know, did I talk about something absolutely completely out of bounds? And I didn't. Okay. You know, so.
Explain your thoughts on the incident with Eric Dubay and who he is and why he's harassing you. Now, from what I understand, he's not a troll. So these are two different types of people.
No. Eric's not a troll. He was, I mean, you could call him a rival at this point. He was one of the guys that was talking about Flat Earth before I was. Sometime at the end of last year, there was really very few people that were dealing with Flat Earth. You had Matt Boylan, who had been doing it for several years, and he had kind of faded in and out doing his thing. And then Eric Dubay, who had made his videos back in December of 2014. And like there was a guy out of Germany called Cesar and a few other people that were doing things. And when I made my clues, Eric really didn't pay much attention. Matt did, but Eric didn't. And then when I started doing interviews, which was almost right away, it was like starting in March, the clues were in February and I was doing interviews in March, one of Eric's people had gotten a hold of me. Eric and I have never actually corresponded in real life, you know, not directly. And one of Eric's guys, though, had written me and said that, look, Eric's very upset with one of your interviews and he wants you to stop doing a couple things. And he listed them very specifically. One was he wanted me to make sure that I spoke of the world that was absolutely perfectly flat, you know, with the exception of mountains and valleys and crap like that, and that there was no warp to it. And the second thing was he didn't want me to ever mention Crow 777's videos again from YouTube. And I thought that Crow's 777's were like the best moon footage I've ever seen, even though Crow was not a flat earther, which really bothered Eric. He was going, no, he's like a holographic universe guy, and you shouldn't mention Crow because it's a distraction from the movement. And I said, look, you know, it's just my model that I'm putting out there. I don't necessarily have to follow anybody's model. I wasn't being rude, but I was kind of implying, it's like, look, I don't need permission to do this. You know, your YouTube videos were only 2 months older than mine. You know, you don't have, if anybody who should have said anything, it should have been Matt. Matt had a completely different take on it than Eric. And so I went and started doing my own thing. Well, you know, his guy said, look, if you disregard his recommendations, which were really demands, he's gonna start coming after you. And, you know, true to his word, he did. You know, he immediately started, you know, throwing out the shill word and disinfo agent and all this other stuff. And I wasn't going to change just because of that. And he never backed off of it, to the point where, you know, at the end of last year, he made a an enemies list, which I hadn't seen since Nixon. You know, nobody's seen since Nixon, where there was like the top 14. Wow. The top 14 guys he hates in Flat Earth, and who was number one at the top of that list, was the only guy that never said anything bad and still has never said anything bad about him, which was me. And anyone that was ever associated with me was in any sort of way was on that list. If, in fact, had because it was before August, had it been after August, Patricia would have been on that list, which was sad. So, he has never backed off from it. He has always, and I feel bad in that capacity because once you get to a certain point, because, you know, he's got, I don't know, 20,000 subscribers, 25,000 subscribers on YouTube. Once you get to a certain point, your subscribers, your fan base, you want to call it a fan base, they demand a certain thing from you. And so even if he wanted to make peace with me now, he couldn't because they would never stand for it.
Well, even if he does, and they do, some people would just get sick of listening to it, and eventually they would quit.
Yeah,
and leave his channel. So two things are going to happen. He's going to start tearing himself down or change.
Yeah.
I mean, that's
the only option. Again, he he's made a lot of good content out there. You know, he made one particular video that was, I think, a bad decision in terms of worldview, which I won't get into. But the rest of his stuff is actually pretty good. I mean, he's made some. I thought his 200 proofs was excellent. He's done some great comprehensive work. Unfortunately, he just built this castle around himself and wouldn't leave. You know, the fact that he broke away and created his own International Flat Earth Research Society, and then, you know, anyone that comes in, if they don't absolutely agree with him 100%, that, you know, off with their head and they're banned. And so, again, I got nothing against the guy other than, you know, his worldview on certain things. But I've said up front, I said, look, if I had to pick some, you know, a small group of people to go in against physicists to debate, he would be in a very short list of one of the people I'd love to, you know, have right there, because he's got a lot of information in his head. But he, you know, the olive branch is out there. He's never going to take it. So I've done everything I can.
Okay, so let's back up and talk about the references to some recent events on their own. One of the events I want to talk about is the Confederate flag.
Sure.
Now that it's taken down, it's also being removed from schools, along with history, the Civil War. I mean, there's a lot of things that are happening as a result, whether it's fake or not. You know, whether they call it a false flag or not, they're still taking this out of history. This is erasing who we are and who we were. I mean, everyone has seen Back to the Future, where he holds that photo up and he starts disappearing and he's looking at himself. And this is, you know, people don't want to talk about it because it's such a taboo thing. But I want to ask you what you think about, if we're doing this to things as small as the Confederate flag, what's going to happen? I mean, do you think that the round earth or globe earth or spheroid or whatever has a place in history where if we start talking about flat earth and people start believing it, people, you know, like I said, you're right, right? So at the beginning of this, you're right. What's going to happen to who we were? You know, are we going to erase this? Or is, I mean, think about the repercussions of deleting things from history. You're deleting a piece of who we were.
You know, it's a the globe model will never be one. It's a cool model, and you know, everybody, you know, we've been so conditioned to it that, you know, we all embrace it, or at least we have. I mean, we all started as globalists. You know,
do you have a respect for it still?
Oh, sure I do. Are you kidding? I used to have tons of globes. That was the scary part. I used to collect.
I'm not talking about collecting and keeping stuff. I'm saying, do you have even now that you believe in flat earth, do you have a respect for the globe model and all that's been put into it?
Yeah, because I believe that the builders of this place, that was part of the natural process. I think I even talked about it in the clue, is where you, to buy you more time to keep the population in its natural state, the globe model is a perfect stall. It buys you, you know, in our case, bought us 500 years, or bought them 500 years. So yeah, I think the globe model was genius.
One of the more recent events that I'm dealing with is the mounds of people beginning to believe that every single thing, everything that's done in the media, everything that's done in the world, any major catastrophe, I mean, you name it, we can go down the list. Mm-hmm. They believe that it's all a big lie.
Staged.
It's the great unlearning.
Yeah.
That belief in everything is fake. Right? So I mean, the thing that I have a hard time wrapping my hand around is how can we sit back and say every single thing? I mean, that's like the Salem Witch Trials, which is what I, you know, we were both talking about that a while back, and we were both agreeing that what they did was wrong. So here it is, history is now repeating itself, and we've got people that believe every single thing is fake. Everything. I mean, all the way down to they're now pointing the finger at normal people like Mark Sargent and saying he's a shill, or he's a disinformation agent. He works for the government. I mean, we're getting to that point. So at what point do we stop and start using some of the logic that we have in our heads and stop, you know, I mean, here's my thing. Was it not Sigmund Freud that said, isn't a cigar sometimes just that, a simple cigar? Yeah. And wasn't it Shakespeare that said, a rose by any other name is literally but a rose? So how do we deal with this? I mean, how are how are you? Because you have literal people that are following you, that believe in you. Yes, you have the people that try to destroy everything, but you have people that believe in you. And these people really do believe what they're saying.
Sure.
When it comes to everything is faked. So, I mean, to a point where some people even point the finger at you. So how are you as a responsible leader? Because at what, you know, like I said, at what point do we use logic in our heads to work and see that everything is what it is supposed to be in our own minds and physically? I mean, without hidden agendas and, you know, secrecy such as hiding behind fake names and like Mr. Osman or pretty much the troublemakers, you know, how are you dealing with this rise in attention and what are you doing to combat the bad stuff? I know you said you don't even look at your comments, but that's part of dealing with the issue. We'll deal with this. Well, go ahead and give me your statement.
Okay.
Because it's kind of important.
Well, it is, but from my standpoint, again, it's hypocritical for me to say, because again, I love how the conspiracy mind, the hive mind of the internet, and really they go hand in hand. The you know, the conspiracy group and the what I consider the hive mind, people that look for the details, because the devil is in the details. It would be hypocritical for me to say, yeah, look at everything else, but don't look at me. Because that's silly and ridiculous. Absolutely, you should be looking at me, because you know, every day this movement gets weirder and weirder and resonates more and more.
What happens when people start accusing you, like the Salem witch trials, and they start attacking the innocent people, like they do? I've seen new people come to your channel, leave a comment, and everybody rip them apart. Wolves.
Yeah, I know. There is no way to combat. I mean, yeah, I could spend, you know, every ounce of my time trying to block and moderate that crap, but it's not going to work, because, you know, you can create so many new channels and create aliases. I still believe in what I like to call the system or karma or whatever it is, and that is what you put out there comes back. I made a decision a long time ago with this, and that was I was going to take the high road and not get stuck in the mire and not get, you know, bogged down with yeah, there's going to be haters out there. Not to quote a very wise young woman who said, haters going to hate. But it's true. They are going to hate, and there's nothing you could do. I watched it. Look, I've watched it for too long. I've watched it since the internet forums first came online. In the late 90s. And that was, you know, 20 years now, where they just, you know, there's some people out there that are just, again, I make this joke, which is you could put a YouTube video out there about a polar bear chasing a bunch of butterflies. And there's going to be, within 10 seconds, you're going to get somebody on there that's going to say, this is the stupidest video of all time. You know, F you, polar bear. And it'll be dead serious. Absolutely dead serious. Or the other side is, look, every best picture winner of every year, you will find reviews out there, sincere, honest, heartfelt reviews, where they'll say, this was the worst movie of all time, and I couldn't believe I actually sat through it, and I'm never going to get that time back. That's like, it won best picture of the year. You know, it won 7 Oscars, and it just blew them away. They do not care. So when it comes to the haters that are out there, I try to put the message out there, which is why I said to the guy that calls himself Tim, which is, look, don't put the hate out there. Be better than this. In fact, that's what I said with the clues. That was the message. When I finally got to like Clue 11, a little bit into Clue 12, but mostly I ended on Clue 11, I said, look, be better than what you are. Be what you're meant to be. Don't be this. And I know it's because our civilization is so passionate, so full of energy, that if we don't have a common goal, we turn on ourselves. I get that. You know, and that is so very, very true. You know, our problems would end. I'm not going to steal too much from the Ronald Reagan speech of the 80s, but it's true where he said, wouldn't all our problems go away if there was a threat from the outside? You know, and he mentioned the aliens. And but it's true. We would all forget what we're doing. And you know, we would stop fighting in the streets. People would drop their guns. And you know, the soldiers would just stop fighting each other. That's what I still believe.
Okay, I'm not going to cut you off. I've got to cut you off because we're heading into the last segment. Oh, yeah,
okay,
we're coming into
go
the
ahead.
Last segment. So
okay, go ahead.
All right, everybody, stay tuned.
Humanastory is the story of humanity, one person at a time. We believe each person has a story to tell, and each story shapes that person into who they are today. Collectively, and more importantly, each and every person's story shapes this little blue rock we call home. We are all together whether we like it or not. We also believe that your unique story might just help someone else traveling down your pathway in life. You might be their guide through this rough time. We are always looking for more exciting stories to share with the world. If you've got one, come share it with us today.
Hello and welcome back to Humanastory Life Presents. We're talking with Mark Sargent and his life in review, and we are now talking about the future. So Mark, so many people in life are concerned with the material. They want to secure their future. They want to make money.
I love you, honey, but you gotta yell.
No, she's fine. She sounds good.
All right. So as we all know, in the end, you take nothing with you. And the only thing is you really leave behind is a legacy of who you were as a person from your actions on Earth. So at this point, you're really nothing more than a fleeting memory in those that cared about you. How you acted in the past and how you act now is how they will remember you.
Karma.
With this said, Mr. Sargent, if you were to pass away right now, what kind of person do you believe
Karma.
The people close to you would remember you as?
How would they remember me?
Yes.
Yeah, as she was saying that, it was basically defining karma.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'll just repeat the same thing that I've just heard, you know, most of my life, and that is, I was a nice guy. I mean, that's going to be a pretty short eulogy, I think. You know, nothing. You know, that is it. If it happened today, you know, now what happens? You know, if there's a bigger legacy, if this whole enclosed world thing comes to fruition, then it might be something very, very different. But if it was today. I am as advertised. I mean, that thing I put at the end, and I know it bugs some people, not a lot of people, at the end of my videos, when I say treat others better than you treat yourself. I mean, it was for me, the Ten Commandments, nobody can remember all of them anyway, were kind of, you know, it wasn't as straightforward as that. And that is, look, if everybody just pays it forward, be nice. That's all I was really asking. So yeah, that's what I'm hoping I get remembered for. That I was a nice guy, and he was what people thought he was.
All right, so as you know, everyone has skeletons in their closet that they don't want in the open.
Yeah.
But as any good psychologist would say, confronting those demons would clear your mind. Is there anything you've lied about in your life that you want to set straight?
Other than the computer game tournament? No. I mean, that's just it. Even the stuff I did, I didn't, you know, wasn't shy about it. I think.
Being a terrorist in a college. No, that's not on the list at all.
Yeah, building explosives while you're in college. No, I don't even feel guilty about that. That was a fun operation. We had a lot of fun and
completely off subject.
Yeah,
completely off subject. I want Patricia Steer to know that gelatin comes from pigs. That's the Jell-O.
Oh, my gosh.
Jell-O. No, I watched a gross video on it, and I got to get it off my chest.
All right.
That gelatin comes from the fat of pigs.
All right. Wow.
I just found this out. So all these people who are eating Jell-O, they're eating pig fat. Sorry, go ahead.
Some people may disagree, but that's fine. But he is
no, it's not. I can prove it.
No, I
Hormel
believe you.
Did a video on it.
I believe you.
Relax.
Anyway.
Sorry.
anyway, other than that, no, there are no hidden skeletons in my closet. Every skeleton has been aired out for a number of years. There's nothing really weird going on with me. So.
All right. Well, is there anyone you've wronged that you would like to clean up?
Yeah, I beat up that kid.
No, I didn't beat up that kid, actually. There was a couple times where, yeah, I know, I know. There was nobody that I know. I've never woken up, you know, in the middle of the night with sweat and saying, oh, man, I'd really like to take that back. No, not nothing. I mean, again, it was, I was fortunate to not have to run into anything like that.
So there's nothing that you've done that you feel is so bad that you've never told anyone? And are you being 100% honest right now?
Actually, yes. I never did any, you know, I never did heroin or coke or, you know, or ripped somebody off for a whole bunch of money. Because I believe that, I honestly firmly believe with all my heart that the karma is a real thing. And you don't have to have a witness there for it to work. That's the sneaky thing about karma.
I'm telling you, you need to watch a show called What About Earl? It's all about karma.
My name is Earl.
Yeah, my name is Earl.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, I've seen it happen way too many times, especially because my sister was kind of evil, and bad things would happen to her, and she couldn't understand why. And you know, good things happened to me. I'm not saying I was Ned Flanders or anything, but it was very true. I saw it, and every once in a while, yeah, I do a little bad thing here and there. But it would come back to bite me almost immediately, to where it's like, okay, I get it. I get the rules of this world. You know, they're obviously not absolute. Some bad people do bad things. They don't get caught for a long time. But I firmly believe there is a reckoning. And so nope.
Okay. Nope. So if there were one thing you could say to your future self, what would it be right now?
To my future self? Oh, you mean, well, I'd probably ask... nothing, because I wouldn't want to know. I wouldn't want to, because everyone, if they meet their future selves, if you watch time travel movies, they always ask, it's like, you know, stupid questions like, when will I die, or you know, what about my love life, or whatever it is. No, I wouldn't want to know anything. I mean, unless I wanted to do a cheat, and you know, what are the lotto numbers for whatever date, you could do something like that, but that's too obvious. No, I wouldn't really want to know. In fact, I wouldn't even want to meet them. To be honest, because when I was 18, I never even thought I'd make it to 40. So, nah, I wouldn't want to know. It would ruin the surprise.
Okay. So, if you could go into the future right now, what would you do and where would you go?
Boy, that's a tough one because you don't know how far to go.
I would say if I could still masturbate at 65.
See, that wouldn't be the top of my list.
It would be a concern.
I don't know if it'd even be a concern of mine. I would go way past the point of natural life, you know, my natural life, and see what, you know, and then look through the archives at that point.
Would you see how the world ends?
Define how the world ends, because now I don't even believe the world. I don't even believe the world does end now. I just think it cycles through to a
you know what? Okay, look. Well, you know what? Even if it did, what happens if there was a mechanical failure in a flat world or an enclosed world?
Well,
there's a mechanical failure and the entire thing collapses.
All right. I would see where our civilization ended up.
There's always a beginning and always an end. So my question would be, I would want to see how the world, how it ends, how it all stops.
Maybe. But again, I'm not one of those. I've never actually gone to the last page of a book. I've never forwarded to the
end. I'm not allowed to put my thoughts in your head. Ignore what I just said.
Well, I just never have done that. So, you know, If I did go, I don't think I'd come back to where I am now. Just to I'd go and I'd say yeah, and then maybe go somewhere else. I don't think I'd come back here because then you're, it's like watching a taped sporting event when somebody already tells you the score. It's like, oh, okay.
It's no longer exciting anymore.
Nah, it's not. So no, I wouldn't ruin it.
So where do you see yourself in 15 years from now?
In a completely new world, because I don't think it's going to take that long. I don't think it's going to take near that long to reach where we need to go. I think it's going to happen fairly soon. And I know people, I'm not any sort of prophet, but I do see this thing happening very, very quickly. So whatever, I'll entertain your thing. 15 years from now, I think this world is extremely different. I think we're in the new cycle. If everything goes well and humanity rises, then it becomes a new golden age. If not, then 15 years from now, it's a pile of ashes, and they're starting to build the new, try to figure out what's going to come next.
All right, so let us paint a picture. As an old man now, you're too old to do anything.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts?
I would hope I never came to that point. I've always been a big believer of quality of life. So actually ever envisioning myself as an old man has never even been a concept for me.
It is now.
No, it's not. Because I'm still a big believer that, tomorrow could be the last day.
Right.
So okay. I don't ever think of it. I mean, if I actually made it, we're projecting that I'm 80 and I'm sitting in a chair somewhere looking out at a pond, I wouldn't be thinking much. That's for sure. I mean, I'd be thinking about a lot of, I'd be thinking of glory days mostly.
All right.
Because
if you could choose one bit of knowledge, one thing that you could get to your future family 200 years from now, what would you pass down?
One thought?
One bit of knowledge. What would you give them?
Oh, that's easy. Assuming that I ever had a family. That imagination is more important than knowledge. That's it. That is that's the only thing you'd need for the long term. That is the most long term concept. And I know I'm stealing a little bit from Einstein there. But it's true. There's a much deeper meaning to that. But
he didn't coin the term. Just remember that.
Oh, okay. It's on most of his postcards, but I know.
Oh yeah. Well, it is. But he didn't coin the term.
But
he
for me, it means
someone else.
But for me, I completely get it. I completely understood that when I was writing the static world theory, which was imagination. And I'm not going to go into it too much more in this because it. It would take longer, and I don't want to ruin it for. I really want people to think it out for themselves. But imagination is your only weapon against eternity, and that's where I'm going to leave that.
All right. So now you're on your deathbed, too ill to move.
Good Lord.
Is there anything that you have yet to finish on this planet that you would like time to finish?
Not if I'm on my deathbed. I mean, there's nothing. No, because I firmly believe that it's going to be finished long before then. That my last goals. Again, who knows? Because the whole.
All right. So Mark, if you had to sum up your future, how would you do this? What would you say to us? And finally, is there anything that you feel that we've left out that you want to add to conclude your future up?
Only that the future is potentially brighter than you could possibly imagine if
a lot of people think it's dark right now, so
I know. It has the potential to be brighter than you could possibly imagine if you make the right decisions, if you just for a second think of someone beside yourself and think of where we could be, think of the whole, think of our potential, but there's so many times that we can't see beyond our own needs and the greed and the lust for power and all that stuff, and that's the traps we fall into. And I know it's partially designed that way, but the future could be very, very bright. And I'm saying this as a warning, what I'm doing now is a message of hope. I firmly, honestly believe that. But it is also a warning, and that is, if you don't change where we're going now, then you'll have, you know, again, the accountability is on you. So that's what I'm putting out there.
All right, Mark.
Mm-hmm.
It is not easy to tell your story, the story of an individual in a sea of people. All who just want to be heard. We are proud that you chose to share your story with us here, and we at Humanastory want you to know that there will always be a place here for you. You've done more than 90% of the world in sharing your life story with us. You're letting the world know that you're not just a statistic or a number, but a living, breathing entity here in the world. We are now going to go to our forums. We were going to go there and read all the questions, but we're really running out of time. Mark, we really do thank you for everything that you've done and everything that you continue to do. We have a lot of soul searching to do ourselves before I can come to a conclusion myself as if the world is flat or round. As you know, and as you've gotten a little intimate with us, let's, you know, be realistic. You've told your life story to us. That's not many people don't do that. In a way, now I extend our offer to you at the very beginning of this, which was, you said yourself that you belong to one club and only one, which was a flat earth society. Now, we don't have a card, but would you consider yourself a humanistorian?
Yes. Yes, I would.
Sharing the story of humanity one person at a time. I personally want to thank you for being on the shows as you have. It's not easy to tell your story to people and lead by example. So, with all that said, we're going to head into a break here shortly. And when we do, we're going to come back and I want you to give your final thoughts out to everybody. And I want you to tell everybody about your website. You'll have about 8 minutes to do so, and then it ends. Okay?
Okay.
Humanastory is the story of humanity, one person at a time. We believe each person has a story to tell, and each story shapes that person into who they are today. Collectively, and more importantly, each and every person's story shapes this little blue rock we call home. We are all together whether we like it or not. We also believe that your unique story might just help someone else traveling down your pathway in life. You might be their guide through this rough time. We are always looking for more exciting stories to share with the world. If you've got one, come share it with us today.
Hello, and welcome back to Humanastory Live Presents. We're here with Mark Sargent, and we just want to wrap everything up and say thanks for being on the show with us here today and sharing your story with us. And is there anything that you want to say to kind of wrap everything up?
6 minutes, son. That's all you got left. And then the world ends for you.
6 minutes. All right. Yeah. You know, a message to the people that are out there, for the people that are, two different messages. One is for the, the flat earthers and all the enclosed world people, and that have been in it.
Quit being pricks.
No. Look, again, this particular concept charges people up with so much energy, and I've just watched it time and time again where they don't know what to do with it. You know, they get so excited and so inspired to where they make their own videos and their own forums and sometimes their own websites, and they just post on just a flurry of things, and they want the world, because it's such a revelation for them that they want the world to change now. And when it doesn't, again, it's kind of like a micro version of civilization. They don't know what to do with the energy, and sometimes it turns bad, and sometimes it turns on other people, because they need to have this focus. They need a target to point this energy at. And if the world isn't changing right now, and the government isn't changing right now, and NASA's still running as far as we know, they don't know what to do with it. And so, you know, we there's been some dissension in the ranks. And again, you couple that with the fact that conspiracy people are naturally suspicious, you know, to the point of high hypersensitivity towards everything, and you know, they look for the devil in every aspect. So,
but that's the problem. If they look for the devil in every aspect, they're gonna see the devil in everything.
They are. And again, I have gone out of my way. I'll try to keep this part short. I've tried to make myself, even with the show tonight, as transparent as possible. You know, there's not that many people out there. You know, there's still a lot of aliases that aren't trolls. You know, I put out my real name, my home address, where I lived before, my backstory, you know, as far as just about everything. And this show helped fill in a lot of those gaps. But I did that because it minimizes the suspicious nature of people when they get the chance. Like, and I get a lot of phone calls. I get people that, you know, tons and tons of phone calls that, you know, people won't leave messages. They'll just hang up. It's like once they hear the voicemail, it's like, oh, well, it sounds like he might actually be a real guy. And it's been an interesting journey so far, where we have had, again, this particular concept. Again, I'm trying to stress this to people. When I put it out there, when I finally had that moment where it's like, okay, I'm going to start making videos, I honestly didn't think it was going to go anywhere, because I thought I was there were holes in the plot that I had missed. And so here we are, coming up on a year since the clues were made, and it's just the amount of people that have gotten involved in this thing, both pro and against, and the people that go against.
Go ahead. I'm going to cut you off because we only have a few. We have 3 more minutes.
Oh, okay. Then I better plug this.
Tell us about your website.
Oh yeah. The main website is called enclosedworld.com. I built it myself. I had to take a programming class to do it. That's pretty cool. On Truth Frequency Radio, I have a little show that they gave me because I was doing, you know, this thing has gotten, you know, pretty cool, called Strange World. I also do a show, as long as it's on, called Perceptions with Jonathan. And of course, you know, the favorite show that I love doing is Patricia Steer's show, which is Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes. She and I have become, you know, fast friends, and have gotten to do some cool things together.
Yeah, I've gotten interested. I watched my first episode like 3 days ago when it was raining here in California. So
cool. And even though I don't like seeing myself on video, she insists on it. So I'm like, all right, fine. Well, it's, you know, it's easier for her because, you know, she could be a model. But yeah, other than that, everything's going really well, and I, you know, my phone number and my email are at the end of every video that I do, or for the most part, and it's on, you know, on my YouTube page. Oh yeah, by the way, the YouTube page is called Mark K. Sargent, or literally, if you forget any of that stuff that I just rattled off, you can just go into any search engine, type in Flat Earth Clues, and you will run into it. It's very, very easy to find, and I hope you get something out of it. How's that?
I think we will. How was that? That's good. That's good. We still have 1:54, son.
Oh, okay. Let me see if there's anything else I can, any little miscellaneous thing. For those people that are, I don't want to end on a bad note, so I'm not going to address the trolls. Let me come at it this way. The Flat Earth Movement, if you give it.
Well, I have what I would like to see is
sure,
all the trolls for once have a valid argument. Put your thought and your mind to work Unless, of course, you just want to do it to do it, in which case, well, you're going to do it anyway. But sure. I would like to see people. I would like to see what I would like to see is how serious Tom Osman is. He claims to be serious. Tim, yeah. Tom.
It doesn't matter. It's not his real
it's
name.
Not even, it's not even his real name. Yeah. I would like to see him, Eric Dubé. You know, Eric Dubé claims to be a Buddhist yoga man.
Yeah.
I want live to what they believe they're achieving.
Yeah.
You know, stand up, say your real name, prove to the world how realistic you can be. If you claim to be as strong as you are, I am your open source. Humanastory doesn't judge. We simply hear your story. And if you have one, tell us your story. Mark?
Yeah.
Thank you for being on the show.
My pleasure.
Have much love and respect for you after this beautiful, intimate moment with you. And welcome to Humanastory.
Humana's story is the story of humanity, one person at a time. We believe each person has a story to tell, and each story shapes that person into who they are today. Collectively, and more importantly, each and every...